Captain James T. Kirk and Commander Spock, sir. Reporting for our 5-year deep space mission.
Oh, nobody told you? We don't do those anymore.
What?
Space, missions, starships, the whole Final Frontier thing. Done.
I do not follow.
Haven't you heard? The portable transporter Khan had that can just send them anywhere? We just made a whole bunch of those. No point in keeping all those expensive ships around, right? Here, watch. Baby Gorn, catch!
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Rollin' 20s. We are the show that found out that Furious 7 had the biggest opening weekend ever for April. We no longer understand this planet. I am Jeremy.
Jesse.
Z.
Remember, you can subscribe to this show and several others in the MSP library at missionstarpodcast.com. You can like us on Facebook, subscribe to us on iTunes and on Stitcher. Follow us on Twitter at The Rolling Twenties. You can send us any fan mail, suggestions for the show, or hate mail at mspfreight@yahoo.com. At the beginning of the show, the music you heard was by Machina Supremacy. You can find their music for free download at machinasupremacy.com, as well as their latest couple of albums on amazon.com. The clip you heard was How It Should Have Ended for Star Trek Into Darkness. They're from the channel of How Should It Ended. You can find more of their videos on youtube.com. It's been a long time since we've done it like this.
Yeah.
That's what she said.
Actually, she just usually tells me, are you through yet? It's been a long couple of weekends, you know, 2 weekends ago I was at WrestleMania, last weekend I was at WonderCon with Steve, who right now is at work, he may join us a little while later. What about you guys, what'd you do with 2 weeks without me in your ears?
I worked 8 days straight, went to a con, and nearly dropped dead on the first day.
Wow!
Yeah!
Need more time on a treadmill, or what?
No! It was poor planning at the hotel. Apparently their check-in time is at 3 in the afternoon, so when I showed up at 7 with all my crap, I didn't feel like living it out at the front of the lobby. So I dragged it for 4 hours.
Ooh.
Okay, there's a couple things wrong with that sentence, but I don't think we need to go over
it
right.
Yeah, I'm just...
Okay, V, did you do anything that made you consider Harry Carey over the last couple weekends?
Oh, no, not really. I've been busy working on my next Pathfinder campaign.
Ooh. How many people are you going to make cry?
So far, I only have 2 players. I'm actually looking for more players, so...
Oh, okay.
If you're free Monday night around 11 p.m. Central.
Wow. Let me see. That'd be 9 p.m. my time. Yeah. Usually, I am just losing the capacity for English at about that time.
Yeah, I was afraid of that. Oh, well.
You know, it's one of the curses of trying to wake up early to go to the gym. I actually had a few scheduled photo shoots while I was at WonderCon. We posted those in the gallery, but they were super nice people. I offered at a minimum of an hour of my time and like several poses for $10. And everybody paid me $20. They said I was really nice. Mm. I even tried to shove, you know, change in their hands and they refused it. It was kind of awkward. But, you know, turned out some fairly good photos and got to see Abby Normal for a while. And I had something new for me. I recognized somebody outside of costume for once.
Who?
It was actually Abby Normal herself. I saw her walking by me in another direction in a skirt and a shirt talking to a couple girls. And I kept rolling through colors in my brain trying to figure out what color face I'd seen her in. Finally got to grayscale and said, yes, I know that one. So that worked out okay, and yes, Jesse, my streak is intact, so shut up. But I wasn't in costume, I was just trying to put people together for a photo, and somebody had a little trouble shimmying up something, so I think I surprised her by how strong I was when I just picked her up by the waist and set her down. So, that happened. Other than that, I'm just trying to get ready for Fanime, Anime Expo, and San Diego. I already went through my storage space and found like 5 boxes worth of stuff to bring with me to Fanime Swap Meet.
Wish I could go to the Fanime, but the funds.
Oh, you just rob a few people. I'm sure it happens in Merced all the time. Let's see. This week we're supposed to talk about the Gen 13, sister series of DVA that came out back in, I think, 1993. Before we do that, we'll just get ahead into the news of the week, simply because we have no Kickstarters this week. No crowdfunders. So we'll jump straight into the video game news. And first off was news I'm not too happy about, and that is the fact that the Batman Arkham Knight game has been delayed again. It's been rescheduled. Its opening is now to occur on June 23rd, 2015. It's not a terrible delay. It's in the same month, but this is the second delay. First it was October 14th, 2014. Then it was June 2nd, 2015. Now it's June 23rd, 2015. What this tells me is I'm going to get no peace during Anime Expo or Comic-Con. You know, I have to go to two conventions and I have to save Gotham. Fucking weekends. But to go with that announcement, there's a new video that was released on YouTube that supposedly was pulled directly from a PS4. Yeah, I know. I said about the same thing. There it is. I don't know if Jesse can watch it because the first thing it says is mature.
Nope, I got my laptop open.
Oh, wow, okay. Yeah, it says the following footage is captured directly from a PlayStation 4 system.
Sorry, I've got
to Wow, Commissioner Gordon looks old.
Barbara. You still know how to make an entrance.
Looks slightly pot-bellied.
Yeah.
We were going to find a military vehicle speeding through Chinatown. It's the only lead.
Looks like Gotham ripped off Big Ben there. You see it?
If you find it,
yep.
Tell your men not to engage. I'll deal with it. Do you really think Scarecrow's crazy enough to detonate a chemical weapon in Gotham? I won't let
What kind of question is that? Do you think Scarecrow's really crazy enough to detonate a chemical weapon in Gotham? Have you fucking lived here?
Right?
Hey, Batman.
He's not insane, but he's definitely a megalomaniac.
No, but I mean, this city, it's like every other weekend is some kind of apocalyptic threat by a street gang. You know, if it's not a chemical bomb, it's Joker gas. If it's not Joker gas, it's flash freezing the city. If it's not flash freezing the city, there's a Venus flytrap that's about to eat you. I mean, come on, man.
This town's full of crazy. The police work with one.
Well, at least it doesn't have the super cognizant telepathic ape like Central City does. Well, there's Batman soaring through the sky. That's kind of become commonplace in those games now.
He has a Pip-Boy. He does!
Wow.
I want it.
You know, I thought we were doing a podcast. Lately, it feels more like we're just doing a bad episode of Mystery Science Theater.
Hey, you know what? That's okay. This looks fun.
It does look cool, and the graphics look great. It's just... damn, dude.
Wow, I had a flashback to Batman Returns for a second there.
I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing.
Oh, I didn't think it was that bad.
Uh-oh. Let me see. 2 minutes in, and we found the ass-kicking.
Is Batman Returns the one with the nipples on his costume?
No.
Batman... Batman Returns was the one where Danny DeVito dressed up as the Penguin.
Oh, okay. I haven't...
Michelle?
I'm mostly conversant with the Nolan-verse.
Oh, well, that's fine. You know, there are certain things to love about the Tim Burton Batman movies. There's other things that really make me question what happened there. Does anybody else notice in this video it looks like Batman's picked up one of the bats and is just beating the shit out of people?
Yeah.
Actually, I hear wood on stuff.
They really upped the game. I mean,
yeah. It looks like every punch and kick is using the taser stuff. Oh, there's a fight ender.
Ooh! There go his teeth.
So, officer, nice of you to take part in that last whooping.
You know, being in an open city, you got better cameras.
You notice how superheroes always have a full set of teeth? They probably shouldn't.
Maybe they just have really good dentists.
That's true. The underground scene of dentists for superheroes.
Is it just me or does Batman look like a linebacker in this one?
Yeah, Considering all the crap he's gone through over the years in this city, he might as well be.
No, I don't mean his guns. I mean that suit. It makes biceps are one piece.
No, I totally agree. It's like that suit just keeps getting lighter and better.
Yep, and there's the bat tank.
Do we just borrow it from Frank Miller's version?
I think you borrowed it from Chris Nolan's version, man. I never saw anything like that until Nolan.
You never saw Batman,
Wait a second, just...
What?
I flipped through it. Is it just me, or did it sound like he had to turn that thing over like it was a Studebaker? I thought I heard that... That's not one sound I would expect to associate with this kind of machine. Oh, cops just died. Yeah, usually direct hits from an RPG will do that.
Who did,
This thing looks fast-paced and it's very interesting, but at the same time, you'd expect one missile from this bat tank should be enough to stop that Hummer. What the hell is it?
Yeah.
He's taking, like, 4 shots at this thing and it's still rolling. What are you making it out of? Kryptonite?
Adamantium.
Would be nice, but wrong universe.
No, actually, she might be apt there. Maybe they did it just to fuck with him. Hey, we found adamantium in this universe. Fuck you.
Oh, I'm sure they have an adamantium equivalent.
Not really.
Really?
Maybe they made it at Bruce Wayneium. I don't know.
No, really. DC doesn't have a fictional metal like that. Well, maybe nth metal.
There is promethium in the DC universe. That's an armor that actually heals itself.
Yeah, nth metal. Yeah, that's the anti-magic metal.
Man, this guy's just dragging himself around and you're staring at him like, maybe you'll live. Oh, wait, do we get to interrogate this guy now? Where's Scarecrow?
Go to hell! Well, considering that there's an interrogate button...
Where is he? And he keeps it! Crush every bone in your body. Okay. He's working out of a penthouse in Chinatown. Oh, that's a legit threat. I swear that's all
I know. Wait, Scarecrow's working out of a penthouse in Chinatown? The other one. Oh, that was a wrist.
Oh!
Oh!
Is he actually going to keep that?
Well, why not? This guy's not going to be able to use it. He's never going to play the piano again.
Although this doesn't have anything on that eye thing from Daredevil.
There's your pit boy. Sure. Is this
what I think it is? Do you think he has to run his communications through Apple FaceTime? You're not kidding.
God, I would hope. Why would he bother? He probably has his own network. What are you going to
do? I don't know. I've seen what happens when corporations put him up like Sprint. I don't know if his would be any better. What do you think his 4G coverage is?
I think it's localized to one city, maybe. He has definitely good satellite coverage, though.
Okay, I don't know how well I would take it. Every time you summon the bat tank, it just comes spinning up behind you.
Yeah.
But what happens if you have a leg cramp?
I'll admit, I think that's going to get old fast.
Yeah, you need to train that thing to sit and stay, dude.
And we're flying again.
Yeah. Interesting video.
Yep.
As much as I'm poking fun, doesn't mean I don't want to play it. I'm just having my, moments.
Hey, we're all poking fun in the good way.
Another game actually has a release date now. Halo 5 Guardians. It's been announced that will be released on October 27th, 2015. It's going to be a busy and wallet-draining year for me, obviously. They've started releasing little teaser hints about what the story is, and it sounds like the Master Chief is being hunted as a traitor during this game. By the new character of Spartan Locke, the character from Halo Nightfall. So there's a couple of clips, they're both about a minute long, of the same scene juxtaposed from the viewpoints of Locke and the Master Chief. This is going to be bizarre. I want to see more Cortana. I really came to like that character. We also have news that there is a new game coming out that's going to make Japanese game fanboys cry. The game is called Shin Megami versus Fire Emblem. This is a game that's really happening.
I barely know anything about Fire Emblem, so what's the other one?
Shin Megami Tensei is known as one of the best RPG series around. Fire Emblem is called just the best, according to a story on Kotaku. I actually have a trailer video that's about a minute long. We'll give it a shot.
Sure.
You know, goodness knows, it couldn't be as bad as Catwoman or something. There it is.
That's as bad as Catwoman.
There are some things, you know, forever. Herpes sore. I think herpes sore is rated as bad as Catwoman. I'm guessing. I still haven't sat down to watch the movie. 10 minutes of watching Halle Berry mince on the screen and I've had enough.
She's not the only one who sucks.
I'm sure. I just can't get past her, and she's the one I'm supposed to be watching during most of the movie.
Yeah. She's just okay, weird. The outfit that they give her for Catwoman just makes no sense and is not sexy.
Okay, this video so far is interesting. It's a combination of CG and it looks like hand-drawn animated stuff. It's not explaining dick to me, though.
Yeah, it seems more like an intro for something.
Yeah.
Well, not intro, it's just, it appears to me that this video is really made for people who are already fans of both series. I don't have any information here to grab onto, and I haven't played either game before.
Yep.
You know, the only thing I've really gathered so far is that they definitely like the women in their games to be dressed either very cute or very sexy.
It's Japan.
I understand that. I'm just trying to give you what I understand from the video so far, which isn't much. You know, believe me, I'm still an anime fan. Do you think I haven't had some frustration with Type B stuff already? Okay, that was an interesting transition from writing machine to writing machine. I still don't understand what the frick is going on here.
I'm seeing way too much Final Fantasy in here.
Well, unfortunately for me, it's a Nintendo game.
Yeah, I don't get it.
I'm not going to see it.
Yeah,
you know, I don't own a Wii or a Wii U, so I'm not going to see this. I know V's just sitting there going, fucking Japan.
I'm confused.
Yeah. I want more information, but that video is just not enough to make me want to try to buy the game. Next video up, I almost wish we had Steve here, because I know he's played this game about as much as I have. Respawn Entertainment has recently been talking about something new they're working on, but they're being cagey as to the details. Fans already have started speculating, though, because what Respawn was talking about was their first game, their first major game that came out for the Xbox One was Titanfall. And they said that for their next project, they've learned a lot about what they should and shouldn't do from Titanfall, so they'll be ready for the next one. So that has people speculating that Titanfall 2 may actually be on its way.
Of course it is.
I enjoyed the game. I wish there was a campaign mode instead of just a PvP all the damn time.
I haven't played it, but I've known a lot of people who have.
It was really good. It transitioned very well from the mech to the interpersonal combat, and then you could hybrid it, and I really dug it. Unfortunately, it just became repetitive very quickly.
I could see that.
Nintendo, however, has decided to do something interesting for their PvP. They're coming out with a new game, which they previewed a little bit of at WonderCon, Splatoon. It's a new shooter where your avatars are armed with colored super soakers instead of guns.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, it's something everybody has a chance to play, not very violent. But Splatoon will have no voice chat due to online negativity, according to the creator.
Okay.
The creator of Splatoon, Yusuke Amano, told Edge magazine, quote, "When I played online games, I didn't like the negativity I got and people telling me, 'You're crap, go away.' So we wanted to focus on the positive aspects of online gaming. I don't want you to misunderstand. I'm not denying having chat in an online game does contribute to fun, but as we've said, we want to grab new people," unquote.
Yeah, that's the big reason I don't play a lot of MMO or FPS is I don't want to get made fun of while I'm learning it.
I've played a few. I've only had one guy, and this was recently, give me a lot of crap. But at the same time, the team leader gave me an apology, and I got 3 rare items out of the mission I was on with him. So, he can go fuck himself. I I do want to ask you, do you guys remember how YouTube lately has signed a contract with Nintendo, which is almost archaic? Nintendo is demanding a lot of rights for their videos and part of the advertising costs and all this shit.
Yep.
Sure.
Okay, yeah, there is one YouTuber known... Yeah, there's one YouTuber known as Angry Joe who said enough is enough. Now, Angry Joe is a man named Joe Vargas. He has about 2 million subscribers on YouTube. And he has announced that he is going to stop covering Nintendo games after a dispute over one of his videos for Mario Party 10. His video for Mario Party 10 was flagged by YouTube. And he could keep the video online, but he couldn't make money off it. So he tweeted his decision back on April 4th that says, quote, "I hope Nintendo America enjoyed the free revenue and coverage I generated for him. It will be my last Nintendo video," unquote. I gotta admit, Nintendo's rules are very fucking bizarre. Although it bumps up against one of those things where we need to have an actual large debate about it versus of, what is it? The rights of the people who created the game versus the rights of those who created something different out of making videos of the game. You know, where does intellectual property fall in that standard? Because Nintendo has one version of it. I'm sure several other companies have other versions of what they consider fair trade on this stuff. We need to find a standard.
Agreed.
Also, as far as E-Player is making decisions, the top pro player of Call of Duty is stepping away from the game. His name is Matthew Hogg. His gamer tag is Nadeshot. And he's one of the more recognizable esports stars lately. He is stepping down from his captaincy of Call of Duty team Optic, and he's leaving competitive video gaming, but only temporarily, he says. In an online video, he said, quote, "I felt my passion to win wasn't high enough to compete at this level. I felt like I was playing not to lose. I wasn't playing to win, so I wouldn't hear the repercussions of it on my Twitter and YouTube channel the next week," unquote. So it sounds like he just lost his fire. As of the Call of Duty Championships, his team placed 7th, and his team on a total pocketed $8,750 for their participation. But Hogg is also part owner of his team, so he's still going to make some revenue of it, obviously. They are pursuing another player to take his spot on the team, and I imagine they're promoting someone else to the captaincy role. And the last bit of video game news I have... I have admitted sometimes when I play certain games, it'd be fun to play it in a simulator. Someone has decided to do that with an old-school original Xbox game, and as cool as it is, I wonder when too far is too far.
Oh?
Yeah. Now, Jesse, I'm sure you've heard of the Xbox game Steel Battalion.
Steel Battalion.
I've heard of Steel Battalion.
Oh, yeah, that's the thing with a huge-ass control setup.
Yeah.
Right, the standard retail on it, if memory serves, was about $160 because you had to spend $100 to get this really big controller set up.
Yep.
Just to play the game. Somebody has taken that to the next level and developed what they call the BSBB. This man's name is Dave, and BSBB stands for Big Steel Battalion Box. And it's a Mark II. He's already made two versions of this thing. The box completely cuts the player off from the outside world. It has air conditioning. It has a communications headset that links up to somebody who's monitoring from outside. I don't know. Would you guys like to see what he's built?
Sure.
Shoot.
This thing scares me to a certain degree. Okay, there it is. It's a 9-minute video. I don't have to watch the whole thing, but this is very involved.
Oh, wow.
Look at the size of this box sitting in the corner of a room.
I dig it.
It looks like the control setup from a 1980s sci-fi movie.
So this comes with must-own house.
Yeah, we're up, and none of us are getting this.
I don't know, you have a garage.
I want this. And I'm not, like, huge into mechs or anything.
Yeah, it has a ton of LED lights, a control setup. It actually has one of those rotating lights on it for danger and everything.
I can't tell if those red telephones are on a screen or are actually in the unit.
I'm pretty sure
they're actually in the unit.
Yeah.
One of those phones will actually connect to the outside world.
Loud.
The only thing that would scare me is if it tells me, okay, your ejection button is here. Does that mean it's actually connected to some kind of, like, rocket-fired chair or something, man? No. No.
Wait, there's an eject button?
That's what scares me. There's cabin and lighting buttons.
I want this.
A fire strobe?
This would get me into mechs.
A fire extinguisher. Really? Pedal rumble.
Fire light?
Yeah. Rumble seat?
Dude,
rumble pedals?
This...
A four-point harn... Man, if you ever just want to sit down and really get into a game, this is the rig.
You know, I'm... This would be a great game to build, like, a gaming store around.
I think they call it Dave and Buster's.
Yeah, well, I meant a much smaller version of that. Like, just...
You know, I saw something similar to this at BabsCon, where they actually set up for a racing game.
Please tell me it wasn't
it was
Super Mario Kart.
No, it was actually like some a Need for Speed game.
Nah. You know, there's nothing technically wrong with this. I have trouble.
I can't justify it. I can't justify the purchase.
I can't justify owning this. Yeah.
Right, but it looks cool. If I had, like, what is it, probably, like, $1,000 or whatever?
I would guess this would probably be closer to about $4,000, really. This is a lot of wiring and work.
I'm just guessing it's at least $1,000. There's no way this is under $1,000.
No, I would totally agree with that. It's like a fanboy wet dream. It is very nifty and everything, but yeah, I could not own this.
Oh, so that's how the eject works.
Yeah, there's two things stopping me from owning it. One would be the cost. The other would be every once in a while I would walk by this thing and I'd hear from the inside, "Dad, let me out! Dad!" Okay, we'll move on to Marvel Media News. We'll talk about Marvel projects that don't land on the comic book page. First news I got is one of the biggest items I came across in the last 2 weeks. There is a release date for Benedict Cumberbatch's Doctor Strange movie. November 4th, 2016. This was an announcement officially that came during a press event for Avengers Age of Ultron and via Marvel president Kevin Feige. They're already planning on beginning filming of this current November.
Wait,
so it's going to be directed...
Yet?
They haven't started yet. They start filming this November. Release date is November 4th, 2016. It's going to be directed by Scott Derrickson and stars Benedict Cumberbatch as Doctor Strange himself.
Isn't a year kind of short for filming and all that?
Typically,
yeah, you could put a wig
yes.
On him.
Yeah, I would say technically yes. However, I have a feeling that Disney is pumping so much money into Marvel movies, I don't think their studio ever closes.
Point.
I think as soon as they finish one thing, they're just going, okay, next!
So they just swap out directors and stuff and still use the same...
I'm pretty sure there's some overlap.
Well, I don't know. For all I know, they just took the wig like right off Chris Hemsworth's head, put it on Benedict Cumberbatch, and shoved him out the door. I don't know. But the other thing that Kevin Feige said recently is he confirmed that the Spider-Man they're going to use for the Marvel Cinematic Universe will be Peter Parker. There's been some speculation recently that Miles Morales will be the Spider-Man that Marvel uses, and Feige has said that's not the case.
I didn't even know there was another Spider-Man, although I don't know why I would even assume that there would be only one, because...
Well, there is, actually, from the Ultimate Universe.
Yeah, the Alternate is kind of a side universe where they started the origins of the universe in the 2000s instead of the 1960s. In that universe, there was a Peter Parker, he died, and there was, due to... turn of events, a brand new Spider-Man, a half-African, half-Mexican kid, which caused a lot of readers to be curious and a lot of other people to go, there can't be a black Spider-Man, no way.
Yeah, shut up and just read it.
It's actually a very good character. I was surprised on how well they did. I can say, though, that they've named the directors for Avengers Infinity War, the two-part movies coming out in May of 2018 and May of 2019.
Uh-huh.
Oh, man, these guys are turning into some of the busiest guys I know in this universe. The Russo brothers are directing the films.
I have no context with those guys. What did he
do? Yes, you do. The Winter Soldier?
Oh, okay. I didn't pay attention, so...
Well, they're about to begin shooting Captain America Civil War, too. And now they're working on Avengers Infinity War, which means the speculation is correct. Joss Whedon, his last Avengers movie, may indeed be Age of Ultron here. That isn't to say he's done entirely with Marvel. He's expressed a lot of interest in doing a female superhero film, but he's just not doing the next Avengers film.
We're talking Chris Evans, right?
No, we're talking Joss Whedon.
Oh, sorry. Chris Evans is also...
Yeah, he should be done fairly soon, from what I understand. They've also hired writers for Avengers Infinity Wars already. According to Badass Digest, Christopher Marcus and Stephen McFeely are going to write both movies. And before you ask how good are they, they've worked on Thor the Dark World, and they've worked on Captain America Winter Soldier.
Two of my favorites.
And they've also created the Agent Carter TV series.
Ooh, even better.
So I would say that these are guys well handled to do this particular group of movies. Yes. Now, according to Instagram, a reporter for the Latino Review had information on one big change Marvel made to the Ant-Man film during reshoots. And that big change, believe it or not, is making their hero a criminal.
According
to this reporter... Well, we already knew the Ant-Man was Scott Lang, but according to this reporter from the Latino Review, instead of making him a quasi-hero going into the film, Marvel did some reshoots to make him a straight-up criminal going into this movie. In the comics, by the time he got the Ant-Man suit, he was a reforming thief. This is not going to be a reforming thief. This will be a semi-active thief for the Ant-Man movie. Hey, you know, there's worse things for people to be. I mean, look at Batman. He's crazy. He gets to be a superhero.
Well, he's crazy in a very contained way. He's not crazy like Joker crazy.
We're talking about
he beats up people with his bare hands on a nightly basis.
Yeah, we're also talking about a guy who, when he lost his mind, decided to take a patchwork suit and call himself the Batman of Zur-En-Arr. Don't even ask me what that means, because I don't know, and I don't really freaking care. however, also, Entertainment Weekly did some... work in regards to Marvel movies for Age of Ultron coming out, and they actually released a picture of what the villain of the movie, Yellowjacket, is going to look like.
Ooh, saw that.
And honestly, this is the most awesome I think this character could actually look.
Oh, that looks cool.
You can actually see plasma torches on his back, which Ant-Man doesn't have, and if you take a good look, you'll see he's getting ready to punch mini Ant-Man down there.
Oh, damn it.
Oh, I didn't even see Ant-Man.
I like the hexagon pattern on the chest.
Yeah, I dig that. I also dig his face guard thingy. Yeah, helmet.
Yeah. This looks way better than I ever could have expected.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
This makes you want to see the movie. I need it to be 3 months from now, damn it.
Wouldn't it coming
patience.
Out again?
Patience.
If I remember correctly, it comes out July of this year. July 17th. Which means I have something to do right after Comic-Con. Shit! God damn it!
Come on, we're less than a month away from watching Age of Ultron.
Oh, I know. And you know that we have to go watch it opening weekend, otherwise Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is going to make no fucking sense at all.
Yeah.
Yeah.
God damn it, I just thought about that.
Welcome to my world.
I hate watching things opening weekend, too.
So do I. I despise it. The only thing I'm going to say is, first show on Sunday is probably what I'm going to go do when a lot of people are at church pretending they pray to things.
I don't have that luxury. Probably do it Friday, maybe. Yeah.
Well, 5-4 Entertainment and Marvel Entertainment are teaming up to create something I never thought I'd hear. They want to create Marvel dress shirts.
Huh?
5-4 and Marvel are teaming up to create a line of outerwear, dress shirts, graphic tees, and accessories.
Interesting.
I don't know how seriously anybody would take you if you showed up to work with, an Avenger symbol embroidered on your dress pocket there?
Well, at my work, it'd be fine.
And mine, that might cause a few questions. You know, I still
I've
wonder
worn
where...
I've worn worse out in public, so...
The thing is, though, there are so many nerd shirts out there for men. Where are nerd pants for men? I don't see that anywhere. You women get skirts, you get tights and stuff, but
yeah,
men just
but
get nerd pants.
Men, in order to, you know, dress up, you have to wear tighter pants to make the prints look right. And on many guys, that's not advisable.
I'm not talking about prints. I'd just be happy if I could wear something with, like, a giant Xavier logo on the outside of the thigh.
Oh, that could work.
Speaking of which, they've announced that they've cast Jubilee for Age of Ultron.
Who?
Jubilee
For the X-Men Age of Ultron film over at Fox. They've picked a young lady named Lana Condor. I'm not familiar with her work at all.
Lana Condor?
Yeah, I really don't know her at all. According to the story on Newsarama, this will be her first major role per IMDb. Interesting looking young lady, I will say that. Let me see if I can open this up.
Oh, she's cute.
And she's not bad looking by any terms, it's just, I've never heard of her before.
L-E-N-A?
L-A-N-A.
L-A-O, Lana.
Yeah, Lana Condor.
Lana! What?
You know, like I said, though, this will be her first major role, so there's...
I didn't know Jubilee was Asian.
Chinese.
Yeah, her full name is Jubilation Lee.
I have trouble telling ethnicities in comics sometimes.
Well, to be fair, though, I think she was played by a white girl in the 90s Generation X pilot. I'm sure that confused a lot of people. Not only that, there was production art that Bryan Singer released that shows potentially what's going on with Angel in the movie.
Ooh, I think I saw that one, too.
No, you probably didn't. Check this out. Because it looks like a vaudevillian stage with the art with Angel in a cage.
Okay. I like it.
Oh.
Or at least I like the art.
I saw the arc. I saw some Archangel Angel pics.
Well, that's the other part of the news, is that not about a week after that, Singer came out with another, production art that shows potentially that Angel may not be Angel at all, at least not during the latter half of the film, I imagine.
Yeah, I saw this.
I know you saw this, because I think half your news comes straight out of my goddamn Facebook.
Really?
But, yeah. Because you saw the two things I put on Facebook, you didn't see the picture I didn't put on Facebook, so... But this picture seems to show a young live person in a black and gray suit with metallic wings and some kind of rudder wings, I guess you could say. It's production. It's production art, which means it may not make it into the end of the end cut of the film. But I'd say it's highly likely. Also, in Age of Ultron news, it's been announced that Jennifer Lawrence has said that after this film, she's done with the X-Men franchise. She's the one that's played Mystique during this entire first-class run.
Ah.
She said to MTV's Josh Horowitz about her role in the X-Men movies, quote, "It's my last one, actually."
Aw.
Unquote.
But she's great as Mystique.
She strikes me as the kind of lady who never wants to be typecast, though.
But I don't see that really happening, because she's a really good actress.
See, I wouldn't worry about her getting typecast as Mystique. I'm more worried that nobody's going to be able to see her without a bow in her hand for the rest of her life.
Yeah, there's that, too.
But she's not the only one who apparently is hitting the end of their rope. Hugh Jackman took to Instagram recently. And it appears that he has announced that this will be his final run as Logan or Wolverine for the X-Men movies.
Well, he is getting older.
Yeah, he's getting up there.
Yeah. You know, I'm not complaining that he shouldn't be done or what he should be doing. It's just one of those cases where I think he's approaching 50, if I remember correctly. And unlike the character, he can't stay young forever.
Yeah.
2 weeks ago, he posted a picture of what appears to be both of his hands, one with claws sticking out, and he put in the caption a very simple quote, "Wolverine, one last time," unquote. It does sound like he's hitting the end of his rope as well.
Yeah. Well, did you see him in the last movie? Like, he obviously had to bulk up extra hard to look like, you know.
The thing is, though, he did look like in the best shape of his life, but I don't think anyone ever asked him to do that. I get the feeling that's hubris.
I don't know. I mean, it's the hubris can be related to, I gotta look good and for this part.
Well, it could also be related to his age, and he may just hit that period where it's just like, okay, and I have to get a 20-year-old girlfriend, and I have to ride a motorcycle, and I have to get a muscle car, and I need to look great!
Yeah.
I don't think he has an issue with a midlife crisis.
You never know.
Well, we're not saying he's having a huge midlife crisis, but as everyone gets older, they're gonna get some sort of, God, I'm getting older kind of crap.
I'm already there.
Well, we've just talked about two people hitting the end of their character arcs. How about somebody at the beginning? This was the first official picture that was sent up by Ryan Reynolds of himself entirely in Deadpool garb.
Sorry, the picture is funny.
It's Deadpool. If you're not laughing...
It was sent out by him, and he says it was the first look of him entirely in costume, which looks surprisingly close. There's also been some recent stills that have been put out across the internet. It looks like filming is in full swing on the movie. According to CinemaBlend, though, one character I didn't expect to be announced for this movie has been. It's been announced that, an actor named Brianna Hildebrand has been cast in the role of Negasonic Teenage Warhead.
What?
Negasonic Teenage Warhead was a character that was introduced in the Deadpool comics. It's a telepathic, precognitive, goth-styled mutant. The name comes from a Monster Magnet song. I don't know what else to tell you.
Negasonic.
Yeah. Negasonic Teenage Warhead. However, according to the casting, this character has the role requires a 3-series option. So she may end up in more movies. Mm. Another actor who was in Game of Thrones has been confirmed in his role in the Deadpool film. Anybody remember the name Ed Skrein?
No.
Or Skrein? Ed Skrein?
No.
He played the first version of the mercenary that is wooing Daenerys Targaryen in Game of Thrones.
Oh. Okay. Him.
He was dismissed from the series and replaced by another actor. He's playing Ajax in the Deadpool movie, which is a superhuman and the person who was in charge of training people during the program that Deadpool went through. So, this ought to be an interesting punch-out, it looks like. Now, has anybody watched any of the Daredevil series that came out a couple days ago?
Watched the first 4 episodes.
No. I watched the first episode.
I thought it was great. Very
I wouldn't call it great, but it was more than enough for me to want to see more, which I thought was just what you wanted from a pilot, frankly.
I watched the first 4 episodes. I was engrossed. It's very dark and gritty.
Yeah, I noticed that when he broke a guy's arm in a knife fight. I thought for a second I was watching a Shadowhawk series. Anyway, the showrunner for Daredevil has announced he would really like to do an R-rated Punisher show.
He would be good for that.
The showrunner is Stephen DeKnight. He was in an interview with Sci-Fi Now, and he said that The Punisher is due for a television series after Daredevil, and he calls himself a huge fan. Quote, I'd love to see him get his due on a platform like this. Nothing would delight me more than to see The Punisher get his own show, and maybe we could convince Marvel to go hard R rating. If any character deserves an R rating, it's The Punisher, unquote.
No shit.
Are you kidding? He sounds like a perfect PG-13 guy for me.
G rating for everybody.
Shoots hundreds and hundreds of bullets and no one dies. Oh, you see that in G.I. Joe?
He's a stormtrooper? But in the vein of Daredevil, they released another one of their little motion posters. This one looks like we actually have what Daredevil looks like in red. It's not what I expected, but... I'd have to see it on the screen. There it is. I sent you guys the URL so you could take a look. Mm. It's interesting.
It looks like his normal suit.
Well, I mean, it's obviously red in body armor. The helmet is kind of interesting with the... it looks like it has little notches that look like horns instead of just straight horns coming off the head.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is nice.
I think the horns were stylized into the actual helmet as opposed to actually protruding.
Yeah. We'll have to see. It's interesting, but like I said, I'd have to see it on the screen.
Yeah.
We also have a photo of what the Thing is going to look like in Fox's Fantastic Four film. You know what? I'm reserving judgment, frankly, because there's things I like about it and things I don't like about it. And I'll let you guys tell me what you think about it. This is what the character of Mike Bell is going to look like stylized up as Ben Grimm.
Ooh, wow.
That looks like, whatchamacallit, the Thing.
That is the Thing.
It is the Thing? Okay.
That's a Fantastic Four.
I was making sure.
Okay.
That's really good.
It's intrigued and... I don't know, I'm on the fence on this one.
That's where I'm at.
I don't know about the design, but the resolution, at least, is...
Yeah, the cragginess of the body seems like it's been turned up a bit. The face looks all right, but the thing that... And it sounds like a pun, but the thing about the Thing is that his face is very over-exaggerated prominent features, which makes him look almost inhuman.
Yeah.
And this looks a little bit too human for my liking. I don't know if any of that made any sense now that I've said it out loud.
I haven't seen any of the Fantastic Four things ever, so...
Well... Obviously, the Thing is going to be done completely CG. I just hope they don't make him way too alien.
I'll tell you what, V. I will send you a copy of an image of the comic book version of the Thing. Take a look at that. If you take a look, I think you'll understand what I mean by being almost inhuman. The size of the brow and just the huge jawline there.
Oh, yeah, the proportions.
Yeah. And the version they came up with of the movie isn't bad, but I've kind of got this predisposed version of the Thing that is vaguely human. And the movie versions so far have all been fairly human. I guess that's the right way to put it. So, I don't know. It's another one of those things I have to see on the screen, although I haven't convinced myself I would want to spend money for this new movie.
Yeah, it's got a lot to atone for.
Definitely has a lot to overcome. Now, if you want to talk quasi-spoilers, I only say quasi because we already know this character is in the movie. Shut up. Hot Toys has come out with a preview of their Age of Ultron War Machine figure. We already knew Don Cheadle was in the movie. His name is in the credits. I just didn't know that they were going to the War Machine for this. I sent you the URL to the story because it would take me a while to pull the pictures off this. But it's another one of their jobs where it looks like if you weren't paying attention, you'd swear they were photos of somebody. And I like the armor, frankly. It looks like the Iron Patriot armor with all the color stripped off it, so it's back to War Machine.
It's very sleek.
I'd say so. And the face they put on Don Cheadle is just too lifelike.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, and now we're into pictures of Black Widow.
Yeah, there wouldn't be too many pictures, but like okay. I said, it's not necessarily a spoiler since we knew he was in the film. I just didn't think they were doing War Machine.
Yeah. Honestly, I expect more weapons on this guy, to be honest. It's War Machine, damn it.
Yeah, we'll see.
Like,
and, what?
I thought it was nice that they actually had the Air Force logo plastered all over him.
Yeah. It's true. I never really thought about it that way. Last bit of Marvel media news I have is that they've released the details as to the pre-Age of Ultron episode that's going to air on April 28th of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Really?
Yeah, the short synopsis is, quote, Gonzalez and Coulson must find a way to put their differences aside and work together against Hydra, even if it means teaming up with someone they don't trust, unquote.
Bored.
Yes! Sorry.
Jesus.
I like Ward a bit much.
Well, if you kept up with the series, you know from the last episode, that's who they're looking for right now.
Yeah.
Makes me wonder if they actually stumbled across one of the robots.
I don't know, although it does appear that they've set up the premise of the spinoff show that they've talked about. Or you guys didn't know about that, did you?
No.
I'm not.
It was announced earlier this week that Marvel is officially working on an Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. spinoff show.
Ooh.
Not a mid-season replacement like Agent Carter. They're looking for it. They're making a full spinoff show.
Hmm.
And I saw a preview of next week's episode where don't kill me, V.
It's okay. But it's okay.
They find out that Coulson has been lying about a lot of his recent activities, and he's been burning through cash, setting up a base, setting up hundreds of bunks for something new.
Ooh. Hmm. Well, that suddenly gives a lot more validity to Bobby or
Bobby and Mac, therealshield.com?
Bobby and Mac's, their group's position.
Yeah, I just wonder what this spinoff is going to be, because they're working on an Inhumans movie, but it could be that they're working on some kind of secret Avengers project. There is a comic called that, after all. Or at least Coulson could be working on it. Maybe he's just trying to recruit a few people he trusts to head up a new team of superhumans. Hey, Deathlok's already there. We'll move from there into DC media news, and the first news we've got is about Aquaman. Word is they've already found a director for the film. Hollywood Reporter is saying that James Wan of Furious 7 is Warner Brothers' top choice to direct an Aquaman movie with Jason Momoa.
Huh.
I don't know how I feel about that.
Yeah, me either.
I'm not a fan of the Fast and the Furious films. I'm not interested in car porn in general, but I've never found them to be terribly well written. Then again, a director...
Yeah, directing and writing are different. Like, I've never seen the films, so I can't really comment, but a lot of people like them.
You know, I've fallen out of love with the Fast and Furious films when I saw the second one and realized how excited they were getting that their cars were going above 90. So, I'm not even a car person. I could tell you that my Scion could do 90 if I floor it. Shit, dude.
I deal with my Metro before I wrecked it.
I'm not even going to ask the question about what the hell that's about.
I don't even want to go that fast.
We also have a new Play Arts Kai figure. Play Arts Kai makes some insane variations on superheroes and other video game characters. Mm-hmm. Check this out. It was announced that this is what they're producing for Batman Arkham Knight. Take a look at this Batman. That looks uncomfortably realistic.
Wow.
The cape is a really nice touch. It has a lot of flow to it. If it wasn't for the seams and the joints, I wouldn't even know that's a figure, frankly. I'm a little creeped out when figures come with 8 different hands, though. Well, it comes with a batarang and a grappling gun.
Interesting.
Yeah. Remember we were talking before about this new Arrow and Flash spinoff show, this superhero team-up that doesn't have a name yet?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they were looking for players for several different roles. We talked about somebody who apparently was a time traveler. I wish I was wrong. Jesse had the guess of Booster Gold. I guessed Rip Hunter, which I thought was a C-list DC time traveler. Unfortunately, Rip Hunter is the character they're using in the show.
Huh.
Although it's kind of a monster manos, because Rip Hunter is probably one of the worst names ever. It makes it sound like he's searching for the seams in young boys' jeans, frankly. But he's being cast with Arthur Darvill. V should know who that name is.
I should? Auntie Darvill?
Arthur Darvill is playing
right,
Hunter.
Yes, Arthur. Yes, I know exactly who that is.
Okay, tell Jesse who that is.
He's on Doctor Who as Rory.
Hey, he played Amy Pond's husband, Rory.
Oh, okay.
How ironic is that? He gets to be a time traveler.
It's so funny.
Is he gonna live for 1,000 years in this one?
Right.
Well, not only that, Ciara Renee has been cast on the show as well. She's joining it as Kendra Saunders, who is one of the AKAs of Hawk Girl. I'm curious to see Hawkgirl in TV show. However, when they cast Hawkman in the Smallville show, he had some of the worst prosthetic wings. So another thing I don't know how I feel about it. I'd have to see it. But they're already joining Wentworth Miller and Dominic Purcell, who are being cast as Captain Cold and Heatwave in the show.
I like Wentworth Miller. And what I've
Yeah, I've noticed that Wentworth Miller on that show, he doesn't call himself Captain Cold. He just calls himself Cold. Which is a good substitution for Captain Cold, but at the same time, I don't know if that's menacing or if he's telling me, do you need a NyQuil? I'm cold.
Would you like
well,
a coat?
My jacket.
Yeah.
How could you be cold with that coat? Speaking of DC casting news, we talked about Jared Leto being cast as the Joker in the Suicide Squad.
Mm-hmm.
He has sent out an image that he tweeted of apparently himself in Joker hair. I sent the URL for you to take a look at.
Oh.
It's not a great picture.
No, it's not, but definitely see the green hair.
Yeah, unfortunately, the camera, I'm guessing, focused really hard on the camera in his hands. He's definitely recreating the Joker's look, or the Joker's pose from the Killing Joke graphic novel.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it threw him out of focus, so it's not a great picture of what he's going to look like. That's probably the cleanest haircut I've ever seen on a Joker, frankly. A movie Joker, anyway. Usually the others are slightly disheveled.
Yeah.
It's also been announced that they've cast Killer Croc for the Suicide Squad. They've cast Adewale Akinnuoye Agbaje.
Okay.
Okay, I'm trying to think about how to shorten this. He was in Thor the Dark World. Let me put it that way.
As who?
Do you remember Malekith had a top lieutenant who turned into a demon?
Oh, that guy.
Yes.
Vaguely.
Okay.
Tall African dude. Can be very intimidating. He played one of the chief roles in Oz a few years ago. Adebisi, I think, was the name of the character. I'll tell you what. I'll just send you a URL, because as soon as I show it to you, you're just going to go, oh.
No, I got it.
Well, V's drawing a blank.
I was busy paying attention to Thor. Probably.
She's so Thor.
Oh, yeah, I know this guy.
Yeah, see? Instantly recognizable. He's just got one of those faces.
Mm-hmm. It's the eyes.
Yeah. Upcoming Gotham teases include potential villains of Mr. Freeze, Clayface, and the Court of Owls.
The Court of Owls is a thing? What do they do?
Yes. Yeah, they were actually one of the great modern Batman tales. The Court of Owls is a group of families and people in wealthy positions across Gotham who have been kind of directing things from the shadows since the 1910s. You know, they create assassins, silent people.
Talons.
I'm a little hazy on the details myself, but think of it as just what would happen if somebody decided to take Batman's crusade and then completely pervert it. It's not a bad premise. I just don't know if the Court of Owls is the right thing for the Gotham TV show.
It's right in line when Bruce Wayne first dealt with them.
True. What, however...
Bruce Wayne dealt with them when he was 10?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's just one of those cases where...
Or however old he is.
Yeah, I just don't know if that's a story I want in the Gotham TV show, because frankly, this show has ruined so many things for me. I don't know if I want the Court of Owls on it.
Well, maybe it'll be better than you think.
I was hoping that when I watched the first 19 episodes, and so far I've been completely disappointed.
Yeah, I stopped watching it.
Yeah,
I may finish the season, but so far, you know, three of the scariest words in the English language right now I saw in a recent ad were new Gotham episodes. I'm trying to keep an open mind. I really am, but it's just killing me. At least it's coming out the same time Game of Thrones is coming out. At least I have something to offset the taste in my mouth. But last bit of DC media news I have is one that was really cool. It was announced at a recent convention, during Mad Monster Con, actually, that Adam West and Burt Ward are working on reprising their roles as Batman and Robin. Thankfully, it involves
Say
no spandex. No spandex.
Oh.
Adam West and Burt Ward will star in an upcoming Batman animated feature film.
Wow.
I don't know what's going on. You guys are just stunned or something. Are you trying to picture like an 80-year-old Adam West in spandex still?
I'm trying to contemplate whether I'm going to give it the time of day.
Are you kidding? This is awesome. It's a new 90-minute feature coming out with Adam West's Burt Ward reprising the roles that made them famous. I mean, come on. If it's the same kind of tongue-in-cheek stuff as the 1966 show, it's got to be better than Gotham.
Yeah. Well,
dude, I didn't like the 66 Batman when I was a kid, so...
You should rewatch it. My daughter thought it was hilarious. Now she swears it's not Batman without Adam West.
I probably wouldn't like it because I don't tend to like that kind of humor, but I'll give it the time of day.
Yeah, me too. Okay, we'll bounce on here. Sorry. We'll move into general... It's okay. We'll move into general media news. And first off is something I didn't expect to actually know about this early. Remember when we read Preacher?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There was one role of an Irish vampire, Cassidy. They've already cast the actor for the TV show of Preacher.
Really?
Yeah, his name is Joseph Gilgun. According to the story on IO9, we might know him best as Rudy in the movie The Misfits.
Didn't watch that.
Yeah, he's joining Ian Colletti as Arseface and Ruth Negga from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. as Tulip in the series. I actually have a picture that I'll send to you. I don't know how to judge it because he looks as gaunt as I would expect from a vampire, but I imagine they're going to use some something to color his hair and a little bit of prosthesis. And again, if you're going to have an Irish vampire, the best thing you could do is hire either an Irish or British person, which they've done. And man, this is not news I ever expected in my lifetime. X-Files is returning to TV.
Yeah, I saw that.
I did too. That's interesting.
Well, they just got a 6-episode green light for Fox. It's going to be a 6-part limited series, according to the Hollywood Reporter, and both Gillian Anderson and David Duchovny are on board.
I'm going to have to start rewatching again.
Well, not only that, the series creator, Chris Carter, is on board as well.
So does that mean that the last 2 seasons are going to, like, not have happened?
You know what? I'm not a fan of the show, so if you tell me all 13 seasons wouldn't have happened, I'd be happy with that.
I like the show a lot.
No, there's a lot of people that do, and, you know, power to you, but it's never grabbed me as much as it did a lot of other geeks out there.
I can see that. I'm not, like, saying it's...
I only remember it so fondly because it's one of the few things I ever watched with my dad, actually.
You know, really? Me too. I've watched that with my dad as well.
Yeah, wow. The other thing I remember watching with my dad is actually The Adventures of Lois and Clark.
Ooh, I'm sorry.
It's something that we all sat down and watched together, so.
Okay.
Yeah, it's something that's good to watch with people because it's just interesting. Some of the
get
a little weird, but.
Yeah, now I feel left out because when I was a kid, the things I was forced to sit down and watch with my parents were Jeopardy and Remington Steele.
It's just there's not a lot of other shows that are really like that I can give offhand, or at least have the same level of writing and atmosphere.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true.
Atmosphere is a big thing.
Yeah. What would you guys say if somebody took a supposed scene from Star Wars and animated it like an 80s Japanese anime?
Let me see.
I'm curious.
There's a person on YouTube with the channel of OdaKing77077. He made a 7.5-minute short film from the perspective of the Empire fighting a battle against rebel forces. And I sat down and watched it, and you know what? I would watch this the same time I would watch Robotech. I would put it on that kind of tier. I sent it. I like how it starts with a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. That's like nerd porn. It's called the TIE Fighter, or it's called Star Wars TIE Fighter. Even has some 80s metal music going on with it.
Yeah. Suddenly flashing to Metalocalypse.
The only thing I have to complain right now initially, it's too crisp for being in the 80s.
Yeah.
It's too sharp.
Yes.
That's one thing 80s anime had in spades, was that all the machinery was glossy. Like, everybody was polishing everything.
Yep. Oh, yeah. I remember this particular art style. I miss watching the ships float by.
I am waiting for the music, and I'm waiting for the X-Wing to transform into robot mode or something, you know?
That would be awesome.
I mean, we're only a minute in. What do you think?
Sorry, that's what it looked like.
Oh, crap, man. I owe you a groin punch, frankly. What do you think so far? It's not bad. There are times where it reminds me of Robotech, and other times I'm reminded of heavy metal, frankly.
I kind of like the style of art, actually.
Oh my god, we may have found V's sweet spot.
Well, it reminds me of Archer.
I can see that to a degree, yeah. I like how it starts up with the 80s music again. It's just a pilot at the TIE Fighters.
I like this.
Look
I like
all the
music.
You have
not
to press
even
this
like.
To launch.
I know, could you imagine what it. The worst part is, all this stuff they're doing to start these machines, if you would just plug the stupid thing into an iPad and press on, it would start already.
Right.
Oh, they're going through all the controls.
I know.
How many controls can you have on that little damn thing? Oh, shit.
I don't know. I'm watching her start it up, and all of a sudden I'm reminded of, like, Iron Eagle and shit.
The flight controller. Wait.
What's... I was going to ask what the little pod with radar dishes was. I've never seen that before.
Communication? I don't know.
As much as I'm watching this video and trying to think of the Empire as evil, all I can think of is how much these guys must have been risking their lives just for their livelihoods and their planets and shit.
This is actually pretty cool. I like
this. This is awesome,
it's kinda like,
man.
It's kind of like the debate that they had on Mallrats about how the rebels were murderers for blowing up two Death Stars and killing engineers and civil people and
this
people who
like
were probably serving food and shit.
All the parts I like about Star Wars, like the space battles and action sequences.
Yeah,
and 80s hair.
Dude, the classic piloting animation you see from any space opera or even giant mech. Is that R? Nope, that's not R2.
Oh, it might have been. Some people have been pissed off enough to blow his head out, clean off like that.
No!
Really, I think that's been overkill. You fire missiles at a thing that doesn't have shields.
Why does that Star Destroyer have humps on it?
Might be something special.
I'm guessing that. I just want to know what those... You guys probably know more about Star Wars than I do, frankly. I was just wondering
what
the... I don't
know. The only thing I can think of is troop transport or shielding. Shielding. It's shielding!
Oh, it's jamming. It's driving them away.
They don't really have shields like that.
Well, they do. They have deflector shields, but they only cover the bridge.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, shields are so small, they can only cover a small area, so that's why only a handful of even fighters even have shields.
Yeah.
You know what? We're 4 minutes into this video. This is the second time I've seen this, and now that I've had a chance to really chew through it with other people, I will say definitively, Cartoon Networks need to hire this guy and make a goddamn series. No, seriously, as much as they're the villains of the show, I could watch an entire series like this based on just the pilots from the Empire right now.
Yeah.
I mean, look at the lady flying that TIE bomber with that massive scar on her face. She's got a story. And I want to know what that story is.
Oh, missile spam right here. Yep!
Starting off with a nasty-ass barrel roll.
Oh, he watched Robotech for that one. And here's the team. Here's the team.
Yeah. There you go, stars of the show. Make it!
Why did they make the... Might sound a bit sexist. Why did they make the chick fly the biggest, bulkiest damn thing with the most firepower?
I don't know. Maybe she's a lieutenant. The fuck do I know? Maybe the other two were too stupid to fly it, for all we know. Oh, and this guy's about to get his super villain moment.
Mm-hmm. Oh, turbo lasers.
I want to see a show someday that does revolve around the villains.
What? What did exactly makes up a turbo laser? Do they fire faster or something?
No, that's just the level of technology that they have.
I don't... It just turbo lasers. It makes it sound like they rubbed all their cannons with cheetah blood.
You gotta ask George Lucas about that one.
I don't know. George Lucas thought planets only had one style of
atmosphere,
environment.
So. Yeah.
Fucking devastating.
Yep.
This reminds me of The Last Stand of the Autobots from
1986. Oh!
I know, I've just dated myself. There's a bunch of people listening to this show going, God, they're fucking old.
I don't know.
Dude, I got
like
a DVD. I'll watch it right now. Oh, ion cannon.
Ooh.
And four. Oh, they're done.
Yep. Fire the reflex cannon! Join the dark side. We have cookies. And it's done.
Dude.
Okay, we've talked about Star
epic.
Wars.
Yes.
Okay. I liked it. I liked it. We've talked about Star Wars, now we have to talk about the flip side. According to Latino Review, CBS is working hard to bring Star Trek back to TV.
I've just been afraid to look at that.
Well, the story has very limited, actually almost no details. But the biggest tidbit, according to the Latino Review story, is that X-Men Days of Future Past director Bryan Singer has been bandied about as an executive producer for a potential new Star Trek show.
Do we have any details on it yet?
Not one. This is still early talks, if there's any actually going on by CBS. I'm guessing that the buzz they've had so far on their Star Trek project, as well as all the homage projects that are flooding around out there, have them, has probably fueled the idea that Star Trek could actually survive again as a TV show.
I feel it could, as long as they...
I think it could. I think they need to get away from the tokens. They need to bring in like more varied races into the shows, because just about everything has some kind of token series you've heard before, usually Vulcan somewhere on the show, sometimes Klingon. They need to move away from that a bit.
I would like an Andorian or a Tellarite. I
know what an Andorian is. I have no idea what a Tellarite is.
You might have seen them from the TOS episode Journey to Babel, where Sarek is on the ship for the first time, and he gets stabbed, and Spock has to give him a transfusion of blood. Oh my god, I'm a nerd.
And she's complaining about our references. I know, you're referencing a show that's actually older than me.
But anyway, the Tellarites and Andorians were like the big... They're really big parts of the Federation. They're mentioned a lot in the original series, and then they just sort of drop off the map after that. I'm really familiar with them from the books, especially.
Okay, I'm drawing a blank, but I'll take your word for it.
They're big and furry.
So am I.
Like, they're giant. Here. I'll find a picture.
Okay, well, while you're doing that, it's been announced that an actress from The Kingsman, Sophia Boutella, has a lead role in the upcoming Star Trek 3. There's no word as to what her exact role is. She is apparently the young lady who had the odd prosthetics in The Kingsman movie.
I haven't seen that, actually.
I need to see that. I've been meaning to go out and do that, but I just keep getting caught up in bullshit. And Simon Pegg says that Star Trek 3 is all about adventure and optimism.
I like those things. In Star Trek.
He described it as at a press roundtable for his new movie, Kill Me Three Times. Quote, "We just want to take it forward with the spirit of the TV show. And it's a story about frontierism and adventure and optimism and fun. And that's where we want to take it, you know? Where no man has gone before. Where no one has gone before. Sensibly corrected for a slighter, more enlightened generation. But yeah, that's the mood at the moment." Unquote. You know what, considering what he's written before, I'll take his word at it. Just give me the movie. Just give me the goddamn movie. Earlier, we talked about PlayArt's Kai and the insane shit they do with some of our favorite and non-favorite characters. Boy, have they taken this shit to another level.
Oh boy.
We've seen their Batman. We've seen their Darth Vader. Can you believe that these guys have made Boba Fett look more badass. Take a look at the URL I just sent you.
Whoa.
They made him look downright dangerous, and take a look at what they did to the Stormtrooper.
Yeah, that's the first thing I saw.
Yeah, me too.
That Stormtrooper looks like he could lift you up by your neck and just crush you.
Like, Iron Man's got nothing on me.
Actually, it looks like for the first time ever they have a training regimen for Stormtroopers. I like the Boba Fett. It actually comes with a flamethrower attachment. Comes with a couple of, I guess you could say, special effects fires for the backpack, a few different hands. Stormtrooper actually comes with a pretty big cannon. And a machine gun emplacement.
I don't have the money to buy all this stuff. I kind of want one of these. I want the Stormtrooper, damn it!
Yeah. I want to pretend it's trying to shoot at stuff and hit nothing. Now, I'm a fan of the original TV show Heroes. It had high moments, it had low moments, but overall, I'm still a fan of the series. One thing I didn't expect to say is that Hiro is returning to Heroes. Masioka has been recast in his role as Hiro Nakamura.
I'm not surprised. He's, like, practically everyone's favorite character.
Not necessarily mine, although he's one of the few characters I wouldn't want to see recast in the show. Yeah. He was so overpowered in context of the show.
Well, he also had a lot of human frailties, which sort of offset that, but I agree, he's not one of my favorite characters either, but...
The thing is, though, I could see why they cast him, because out of the entire series, he was the only one that had hope throughout it. Everybody else was brooding, had all their problems. No matter what was thrown his way, girlfriend lost in time, being lost in time himself, finding out his hero was bullshit, he retained hope.
Yeah.
The guy was like the Barry Allen of this universe. Everything about him was just hopeful. So, hopefully they just don't have him doing too much in the series. That's all I ask. Now, of things that I wish would stop being made. I fucking hate these people. They're working on a new set of Transformers films. What? Continuing the stories they've already done. And they've hired Akiva Goldsman to fast-track sequels and spin-offs in this series of films. Akiva Goldsman is to head up a writer's room of creative minds to create and develop ideas for a multi-part Transformers sequel and potential spin-offs from the Hasbro toys.
So basically they're trying to compete with the Marvelverse and the DC universe.
Essentially, yes, but they have much less to work with, obviously.
Duh. They're going to have to expand a lot if they do that.
You know, and I will freely admit, the first Transformers film, loved it. Has a bunch of flaws, but I love the movie.
Yeah, I gave it a pass, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Second one, nearly killed me. Third one, brought me back in enough for curiosity. Fourth one, just fucking stabbed me.
I didn't actually watch the fourth one.
I've had enough, but they're still going to continue forward with this line of thought. If you're going to do this, though, you have to let Michael Bay go. You need to bring in a new director and bring in some new ideas.
Bring someone that's actually mature. How about that first?
Okay, so that means I can never have the job. Thanks, Jesse.
You're welcome.
Now, Game of Thrones is restarting tonight. Season 5 starts tonight. And believe it or not, they've admitted that the TV show will spoil the books.
Yeah.
According to David Benioff, who's one of the showrunners, and D.B. Weiss, they said at the Oxford Union over the weekend via Vanity Fair, quote, "Luckily, we've been talking about this with George for a long time, ever since we saw this could happen, and we know where things are heading. So we'll eventually, basically, meet up at pretty much the same place where George is going. There might be a few deviations along the route, but we're headed towards the same destination. I kind of wish that there were some things we didn't have to spoil, but we're kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place. The show must go on. And that's what we're going to do," unquote.
This was they could do what Naruto did?
This was inevitable. What did Naruto do?
Years of filler?
Yeah, I don't think you can do that with Game of Thrones because A, the actors age.
Yeah, that's the big thing.
And B, if they do what Naruto did, we'll be waiting for about 8 years before we get to the end of this fucking series.
I mean, they could fill it with flashbacks or be like, and we're going back to Rhaegar, but...
Or they could just keep injecting Maisie Williams with something to keep her from aging. I swear to God, it's like she gets no taller.
Right? Which is good, because she's supposed to be this sort of the same age. Meanwhile, Bran is, like, voice-breaking.
Oh, he's growing like a weed! You know, this kid's going to be 8 feet tall.
Yeah.
Also, speaking of Game of Thrones, they built the world's largest fire-breathing crane for this series.
Whoa.
Fortunately, they're not featuring the crane, but it is standing in place of Drogon in the series, the large dragon that Daenerys Targaryen is raising.
Mm-hmm.
According to VFX supervisor Joe Brower, quote, Drogon is twice the size he was last year. He's about 40 feet long and 20% bigger than the other two dragons. He's also the alpha, so his way goes. He's still affectionate with Dany, but he's got his own mind and he needs her less, just like any child growing up. Drogon gets to perform more this year than ever and have complex interactions with Dany, unquote. And to create Drogon's movements, they started with a techno dolly, a 15-foot crane they used to hold a camera on a telescopic arm. But instead, they put a flamethrower on the end of it. According to showrunner D.B. Weiss, quote, standing 50 feet away from the dragonfire, you could get a nice tan, unquote. Yeah, you go do that.
I'm looking forward to this so much.
When you have the words fire-breathing crane added anywhere, I'm far away. Now, we just talked about this particular person, Maisie Williams, the person playing Arya Stark in Game of Thrones. Can you believe that Arya Stark is about to travel through time?
Huh?
The BBC has announced that Maisie Williams will guest star in the 9th series of Doctor Who.
Oh, that's right.
The girl is like bite-sized. But they're currently filming the 9th series this year. It's going to return to TV, I believe, in October of this year. They didn't confirm who Maisie Williams will be playing on the show or what episode she'll be in, but Stephen Moffat did have this to say. Quote, we're thrilled to have Maisie Williams joining us on Doctor Who. It's not possible to say too much about who or what she's playing, but she is going to challenge the Doctor in very unexpected ways. This time, he might just be out of his depth, and we know Maisie is going to give him exactly the right sort of hell, unquote.
Huh.
If the Doctor sits down and asks her, what do we say to death, I'm going to flip the fuck out.
Well, Stephen Moffat is a Game of Thrones fan.
You know, that would make me laugh myself stupid if Peter Capaldi starts doing, like, bad quotes. You know, what happened to you? You look like your dad's head got cut off today.
He could make a Game of Thrones reference.
No. The thing is, though, if it goes well, you know people are going to be screaming for Maisie Williams to be like the next companion or something.
Dude, I was already plotting that in my head and trying to think if it'd be weird for an old guy and, like, rather young. I don't know. How old is she?
I do not know. Did you know we saw her at the last Comic-Con?
I think I heard about that, yes.
Yeah. It was a strange thing because for us, Comic-Con was technically over. We were walking to an event. We were walking past a couple of hotels. I won't say which one, just because I don't want people camped out. But we saw three SUVs, and I'm one of those people that when I walk, I look everywhere. It freaks people out, but I do. And as we were walking past the second SUV, I caught this tall guy with sunglasses sitting in the window. And because of the light flooding through, I saw the other side, the street side of the SUV. And there was a profile of a person just kind of staring out at it. She looked like she was a little bit perturbed, but it was Maisie Williams just sitting there, probably waiting for her flight. It was just one of those odd moments that happens only at Comic-Con, you know? Now, in the bend of Doctor Who, would you like to give children something that would make them never sleep?
No.
No.
Oh my god, no.
I don't know why you would invent this, then. Take a look at this and tell me what you think.
God.
I want it.
It is 6.5 inches tall, is adapted to be used with US plugs. You can flick it on, and what people don't understand is happening right now is someone created a Doctor Who Weeping Angel nightlight.
It almost the
I put that in my bathroom behind a corner. And
I will be honest, it almost looks like the arms are looks like they're cut.
Mm-hmm.
You can attach a motion sensor to this thing.
But the thing is, though, if your kids watch Doctor Who with you and you plug this into the wall and say, good night, honey, they're never fucking sleeping. Because they're going to think as soon as they take their eyes off this thing, they're dead.
No, the thing is, you get really creative with this with some motors and a motion sensor, and basically have the arms go down when, as soon as it detects any motion, puts the arms back up.
The thing is, Jesse, you could start freaking people out pretty easily, because this thing is being offered by ThinkGeek.com at $20. And I just opened the website, and it's already out of stock. There's a bunch of evil fucking people out there.
I'm one of them, because I wanted it.
Well, we talked a couple weeks ago about Mark Miller, the creator of Kick-Ass. He started a new series based on, like, 1950s and 60s superhero called Jupiter's Legacy. According to The Hollywood Reporter, Lorenzo Di Bonaventura, one of the people responsible for Conan, Conan the Barbarian, has optioned has optioned Jupiter Legacy for a movie. Hmm. Di Bonaventura, you know, he's got his fingers in a lot of different pies. He's one of the people responsible for bringing both the Matrix and the Harry Potter film franchises to movie screens. So arguably, this guy working on it is not a bad thing. Now, he has started his own production company, which has developed both the G.I. Joe and Transformers movies, so maybe I'm giving him too much credit.
Now, if he just stopped with one Matrix movie...
I'm sure he was very happy to stop, but, you know, money talks. The same reason why Hulk Hogan keeps wrestling. You know, you give him enough money, he'll get out there with his back brace and keep throwing people out of the ring.
He still wrestles?
Once in a while. Last bit of general media news I have is one that makes me smile, frankly. Because it's finally official. The Incredibles is getting a sequel.
Oh, about damn time.
Yeah, Brad Bird, who wrote and directed the movie, has confirmed in an NPR interview that he's returning to write the sequel. He said, quote, "I'm just starting to write it. It's percolating," unquote. That was such an entertaining fucking movie. V, have you ever seen The Incredibles?
No. I'm familiar with it. I've seen, like, parts of it.
I would actually recommend it, because the best short description I could give you, it's what would happen if you took an intelligent version of the Fantastic Four and crossed it with James Bond.
Yeah.
Your superheroes are secret agents. It was a really nifty movie. And it's one of the few times I've seen Samuel L. Jackson in a movie where he didn't scream motherfucker at the top of his lungs.
Doubt Disney was going to let him do that.
I don't know. It's kind of his calling card.
They almost did, though. No, recall seeing where they kind of alluded to it, but...
If there was ever a scene where he's going to do it, that scene near the end where he's arguing with his wife about where she put his super suit.
Yep, that's the one I'm thinking about.
That was priceless. You know, woman, we're talking about the greater good. I am your wife. I am the greatest good you are ever going to know.
I think that's a direct quote.
Close. We'll move into Marvel comic news. We'll talk about the Marvel comic projects coming up. Marvel's announced they're doing a new bi-monthly anthology series putting a spotlight on female superheroes. There seems to be a major push lately to put female superheroes at the forefront of everything. The first volume of this series is going to contain issues of the new Thor, Miss Marvel, the unbeatable Squirrel Girl, Black Widow, Captain Marvel, and She-Hulk. A bi-monthly series focusing on the strength, courage, and power of Marvel's female heroes. They're calling it A-Force. Okay.
I don't have much to say about that.
Yeah,
I don't have a problem with female-led books as long as you're not forcing it down people's throats. I mean... It seems to be all kind of women-led books lately, but it almost seems...
I don't know. It seems
very forced without some kind of male counterpart there.
Yeah, I mean, I don't get the all-female thing. That's... If you're trying to cater to women, I like to see some men.
Solo series I can understand. I mean, you know, when you write a book named after a certain character, you expect that character to show up. When it comes to team books, though... Sometimes you can only measure the sexes versus their performance with the other sex.
I'm just worried that if it's an all-female team, it's going to get really catty.
It could also risk instant ridicule and people not buying it just because that's the perception of all you're doing is just giving us women for the sake of giving us women.
Yeah.
So it's a double-edged sword.
For one reason or another.
Yeah. Rick Remender is returning to the Secret Wars. He's going to write a series called Hail Hydra. Rick Remender is one who has written a lot of recent comic book events, including Axis, I believe. This version is going to have Captain America's quasi-son, Ian, carrying the shield in a part of the Secret Wars battle world that's ruled entirely by Hydra. I don't know what else I can say about that, because I'd have to explain a lot of shit to get you guys up to date as to what all this means. I'm interested, but I'm not. That's the best way to put it. Secret Wars is going to introduce a mashup super team, though, that they're calling Captain Britain and the Mighty Defenders. However, this isn't going to star any Captain Britain I've ever seen before. There's a character from Captain Britain in the MI-13 called Faiza Hussein. She found Excalibur in the series. She's the one taking the role of Captain Britain in this series. And she's going to be flanked by Rescue, She-Hulk, the Prowler, and White Tiger. This is one of those things that's either going to be awesome or it's going to be awful. They're also... God, I don't quite know where this is going, because according to this, Captain Britain the Mighty Defenders is going to be set in a part of Battle World called Mondo City 1. Mondo City is going to be a ripoff of Mega City in the Judge Dredd world, because it's being ruled over by the bosses, who are Judge, Jury, and Executioner. Toughest of them all is Boss Cage, an aging but still undefeatable clone of Luke Cage's grandson, Danny. This has, like, 80s movie written all over it. And the Secret Wars are also returning to the Spider Island and MC2 universes. And they're also going back to the House of M during the Secret Wars. That's a lot of Marvel events we're going to spin through. However, we are starting to get some details about series coming out after the Secret Wars is over. They've revealed the full lineup for the new series of The Uncanny Inhumans, and one of them isn't even an Inhuman. The full team appears to be... God, Medusa, Nadja, Inferno, Triton, Iso, and Johnny Storm.
Okay, there's the odd man out.
Yeah, the Human Torch is going to be an Inhuman for all intents and purposes in this series. Most of the characters... he dated Crystal, Medusa's sister. I don't know. Crystal always seems to get thrown in to create awkward relationships across the Marvel Universe. She married Quicksilver for a while. But most of the character, or half the characters in Uncanny Inhumans have been introduced in the recent Inhumans comic series. Probably the bigger news, though, was that they're introducing what they call the all-new, all-different Avengers post-Secret Wars. And it's going to be the new female Thor, Sam Wilson as Captain America, Iron Man, The Vision, Kid Nova Sam Alexander, Miss Marvel, and Miles Morales. The Ultimate Spider-Man is going to be an Avenger. There's going to be a story there, and I'm curious to know what it is, but a lot of these are like legacy superheroes. They're second and third versions of other characters. I can tell you guys are just wrapped.
I'm at a loss for things to say.
Okay. I'm not sure what to say, yeah.
Well, how about this? There was some drama at WonderCon, apparently. We've talked about C.B. Cebulski. He became Marvel's senior vice president in charge of creative and creator development. He sent out some tweets about WonderCon, but not about the convention, about somebody at WonderCon. He didn't say who, but on April 4th, he sent out the tweet that said, quote, "If you miss your Friday deadline and promise your editor you'll slave all weekend to finish, don't go to WonderCon and post commissions online," unquote. He continued, quote, after the same artist ducked his editor and went to ECCC last weekend too, without having turned in a single page, unquote. Whomever he's talking about must have seen the tweets, because not long after that, he put out another one that said, quote, "Now, this artist is deleting/hiding posts from WonderCon. How about you get in your car, go home, and get to work before you're fired," unquote. Sounds like someone got the message. All this happened on April 4th while Steve and I were at WonderCon. I'm curious to know who he was talking about. However, there's also a part of me that doesn't want to know dick about what he's talking about. As far as DC comic news goes, we have to start off with a little bit of sad news. One of the co-creators of Lobo passed away at the end of March.
Oh.
Roger Silfer, he was a writer and editor for Marvel and DC Comics in the 70s and 80s. He passed away on a Monday, according to his sister. He was best known for co-creating Lobo with Keith Geffen in the Omega Men series in June of 1983. Lobo was originally created as a parody of popular anti-heroes like the Punisher and Wolverine. But the character so outpaced his guest starring role in the Omega Men that he got his own series. So that's sad news. Just when his character was getting recreated for a new age, too. And how about this for consistent news? For DC's Convergence event, which is now going on, there's going to be a pre-Flashpoint all-female Justice League. It's a pre-Flashpoint version of Zatanna, Supergirl, Jesse Quick, Vixen, Jade, and Mera, who've been put together in their own Justice League team under the title of Convergence Justice League. This goes right back to the same conversation we had about 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, the thing is, I have more faith in Marvel than I do in DC.
I just see it going the same way. The first ever sketch of Wonder Woman is going on sale, though.
Sketch?
Yeah, H.G. Peter was he did the sketch for William Marston's creation of a new female superhero, which became Wonder Woman. The production sketch, the first sketch of this character in costume, is going on sale. The sketch also includes comments from both Peter and Marston about the design. There's, like, handwritten notes on the edges of the paper about what they think of the designs. Peter's original letter says, quote, "Dear Mr. Marston, I slapped these two out in a hurry. The eagle is tough to handle. When in perspective or in profile, he doesn't show up clearly. The shoes look like a stenographer's. I think the idea might be incorporated as a sort of Roman contraption. Signed, Peter," unquote. Marston's feedback was, quote, "Dear Pete, I think the gal with the hand up is very cute. I like her skirt, legs, and hair. Bracelets, okay, plus the boots. These probably will work out. See other suggestions in clothes. No on these and the stripes, red and white, with eagle's wings above or below breasts as per enclosed, leave it to you. Don't we have to put in a red stripe around her waist as a belt? I thought Gaines wanted it. Don't remember. Circlet will have to go higher, more like a crown. See suggestions enclosed, see you Wednesday morning." Unquote. You guys want to see the sketch real quick?
Yeah.
Sure.
This character came a long way from her original designs.
I think this
was—that's what I was thinking when I first saw this.
That's cute.
Yeah, this character made Wonder Woman made her debut in All-Star Comics number 8, produced in 1942.
I like that style of art.
I look at this and I wonder what happened to get her to where she is.
Wonder why they went with the never mind.
The strappy sandals?
Yeah.
Right. I don't know.
It's vaguely Roman.
Vaguely, but well, very vaguely.
Why didn't they stick with it?
I don't know. I'm
pretty sure they went with boots instead.
Yeah, they eventually came to hooker boots, but I admit, I've never seen the original appearance of Wonder Woman. This is DC comic news, but this is not words I ever expected to say. There's a new crossover coming out between the Green Lantern and Star Trek.
What?
How? IDW and DC Entertainment are teaming up to produce a crossover of the Green Lantern and Star Trek.
Oh, in comics.
Oh, wow.
Yes, a comic book crossover. I'll send you what I think is a proposed cover for this crossover, and you'll see what the enemy is and go, oh.
Cute.
Now, what Jesse is responding to is you have a cover that looks like the Green Lantern flying, the modern version of the Star Trek cast, an Owen Guardian, and what appears to be the Klingon General Chang carrying a yellow Sinestro Corps ring.
Oh. I just connected the dots on that one.
Yeah, he's a yellow lantern. So, that happened.
Nice.
I don't know what to say about it. This is one of those things that'll either be great or it'll be terrible.
You know what? I think we should cover it. Just because.
I agree. We should cover it.
Oh my god, there's a coup going on.
You know you were going to suggest it.
I might eventually. Last bit of DC comic news I have was something that was both a surprise and not a surprise given DC comics history. Batgirl, as you know, as of issue 39, underwent a radical change. Babstar redesigned her. She has that new jacket and cowl look, is going to grad school, and the tone of the comic is much lighter. It's probably the first Bat Family series that hasn't involved a whole lot of brooding. But, believe it or not, DC Comics originally just did this as a 6-month experiment.
Really?
They gave Babstar, Brandon Fletcher, and Cameron Stewart creative direction in the book, knowing that 6 months later they're going into Convergence, and if they didn't like it, they could just wipe it out anyway. They didn't expect it to be as popular as it was, or at least they weren't counting on it, so originally it was just a tryout.
At least they gave it a shot.
Well, hopefully they're going to let it continue. I mean, Babstar has really turned that book around. You should have seen the line at her booth at WonderCon. It was always at least 8 people deep as soon as the doors opened.
How many people do you see dressed cosplaying as Batgirl over there?
I saw 8. I saw 3 of them as the current version of Batgirl. Why do I know that so quickly off the top of my head?
You're a nerd.
Wow, it wasn't just nerd. I mean, I almost wonder if I was skirt watching or something and wasn't paying attention. Which wouldn't bother my wife at all. She'd probably find it funny. From there, we'll move into general comic book and convention news. The first one is a longtime comic creator, Scott Lobdell. He's teaming up with Aspen Comics to produce a new series called The Four Points. The synopsis is, it's a magic and mystery story featuring a woman who was once the black sheep of her family, but ends up inheriting the family empire and its problems. Judging from the early preview of the book, it almost looks like she's going to team up with 3 other women, and each of them represent the 4 points of the compass, or a different element. It's one of those things that sounds like it could start off very stereotypical. If the writing's good, it could break off in its own great direction. But won't know until it comes out, unfortunately. However, Aspen Comics is the production company that started out with things like The Witchblade and, I think, Fathom. So, it has possibilities. I am saddened to find out that WonderCon is moving next year. WonderCon is leaving the Anaheim Convention Center for a 1-year contract with the Los Angeles Convention Center. I don't like that news. It's a 1-year contract, and Comic-Con International rarely does that. Speculation is that they're probably moving simply because there's impending construction going on for an expansion of the Anaheim Convention Center. They probably don't want any interference with the likely areas of movement blocked off while they do that. I've come to really not like the Los Angeles Convention Center. Between the union rules and the jerks working there, it is not a fun place to be. They've nearly ruined a few of my conventions out at that location. There's also news that Orlando's comic book convention, MegaCon, which happened recently, it's been sold. The convention rights have been sold to Fan Expo Canada.
Canada?
Yeah, there's a comic book convention in Canada called Fan Expo. It usually does fairly well for itself. But the MegaCon name and convention has been sold to this Fan Expo Canada corporation. MegaCon has a history, too. It was founded in 1993 and was briefly owned by CrossGen Entertainment from 1999 to 2003. Then it was purchased by Widera, and as that company began to falter, its owner and operator... they worked as the owner and operator, and in 2014, attendance for MegaCon broke its own records with over 80,000 people. What are you doing that's so stupid if you have a convention of 80,000 people and can't break even? Maybe I should ask the Society for a Promotion of Japanese Animation. We do have a little bit of Comic-Con news. Outlander is going to have an appearance during Comic-Con.
Outlander?
Oh, no, wait. Check that. There's an Outlander contest going on as far as Comic-Con right now. It's called the Escape with Outlander Sweepstakes. To enter, you just visit the StarsOutlanderSweeps.com website and enter your name, email address, phone number, and birthday. And you're entered for round-trip airfare for 2, 2 passes to Comic-Con, accommodations for 2, and a spa gift certificate. That's all it asks, is for your name, email address, phone number, and birthday. It's not a lot of information for a sweepstakes like this. They've also announced another wave of guests now that WonderCon is over. Sergio Aragones is going to Comic-Con. He's been a cartoonist for Mad and Gru. Mark Evanier, he's been a writer and producer and comics historian. He's also worked on The Garfield Show and The Art of Simon and Kirby Studio. Dave Roman is a writer and artist for Astronaut Academy and Teen Boat. Raina Telgemeier, who's a writer and artist for Smile, Drama, and Sisters. And Craig Yeo, author, editor, and designer, and comics historian. My God, Comic-Con is only 86 days away. Pretty soon we'll actually have to look each other in the face. Scary, isn't it?
I'll see the money parts.
Yeah, I'll have to remember to do something with my hair.
Wait.
What hair?
I was just about to say, you have hair?
I just wanted to see who's paying attention. In further Comic-Con news, if you recall, we were following for a little while the crowdfunder for Con Man, new series with Alan Tudyk.
Mm-hmm.
There's a question regarding San Diego Comic-Con and Nerd HQ, and on Reddit, they responded that, quote, there are developments, and they are working on it, unquote. Mm. So it sounds like if they're not appearing at Comic-Con itself, they may appear at Nerd HQ. Yeah. I think that's good news, though. This is the kind of series that needs to happen at Comic-Con. And if they go, you can bet that panel is going to be very crowded. The stars of Firefly making a brand new series just about conventions.
Right? It's very meta.
Just about. Her Universe and Hot Topic are teaming up for the second annual Geek Couture fashion show for Comic-Con. They're going to have a few designers showing off original designs based on comic book characters. And they've announced parking rates and locations for San Diego Comic-Con 2015. Parking at the convention center would run you $15 a night. At the Hilton Bayfront Garage, $15. At Tailgate Park, $30 or $40. The MTS lot would be $40. Padres Parkade would be $40. Diamond View Towers would be $30 or $40. Horton Plaza would run as expensive as $25 per day. God, some people know they just have you by the balls if they're going to charge you $40 a day for parking at a comic convention.
Mm-hmm.
They've also moved to another lottery-style system for parking. So it's not based on when you log in, but just luck of the draw. There was an ad for Heroes Reborn that said on it, quote, this summer at Comic-Con, unquote. So it looks like they're bringing Heroes, or NBC is bringing Heroes Reborn for some kind of presentation at Comic-Con.
That should be interesting.
And if they bring Masioka, the place might explode.
Oh my God, yeah.
This is news I didn't expect, and I think it caught a lot of people by surprise. Lionsgate Entertainment is teaming up with Comic-Con International for a subscription video-on-demand service.
Wait, what?
Yeah, Lionsgate put out a press release on April 9th that says, quote, the new service will launch with broad portfolio of content, including original short-form content created exclusively for the channel subscribers, films and television series from Lionsgate and other studios designed to appeal to the diverse interests of Comic-Con's fan base, as well as exclusive archive footage from Comic-Con's 45-year history. As part of the new channel, the two companies will also work closely to make the Comic-Con International Independent Film Festival a 365-day-a-year online event. Unquote. There's actually going to be a new streaming video channel all about Comic-Con.
Nice.
As excited as I am, there's a little bit of me that wonders, is this too much of a good thing?
Why would you think that?
You can get oversaturation on anything.
No, oh, yeah. That's true.
You know, and the biggest reason I could think to have this channel, frankly, if you were one of those people that has a yearly problem trying to get into the convention. Because now that G4 shut down, I don't know anybody that's doing, like, live coverage of the Comic-Con floor anymore. This would definitely step into that slot anyway. I don't know, I'm just speculating. Last bit of general comic book and convention news I've got. I remember when I first read that TwitchCon was going to occur this year, September 25th and 26th in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
On the original story on IO9, somebody identifying themselves as a member of the board on the SPJA and running Anime Expo said that they didn't understand why you would do this, because they didn't think that TwitchCon would have enough of a market to float a convention. They also said that putting it in San Francisco was a mistake because of how expensive of a venue that is, and they just didn't think it was going to be successful. Well, badges for TwitchCon went on sale on April 9th. The weekend ticket, mind you, this is a 2-day ticket, would have cost you $76.50. They sold out of weekend passes in 24 hours. Single Friday and Saturday tickets are still available at what they call early bird pricing at $45 and $54 apiece. No market, eh?
I don't think they understand how wide of a net Twitch has.
You know, I'm starting to wonder if this is not an example of Twitch's reach so much as how out of touch the people running the SPJA and Anime Expo are.
Because I'm not a little bit from column B.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of Twitch, but I can tell you how big of an influence Twitch is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, shit. Twitch parties at conventions are some of the liveliest events that happen. So a convention floating around it, yeah, solid idea. You know, the only way it's gonna fail is if this year is really, really bad. But if you're inviting the right Twitch streamers, I don't see a way it's going to be really, really bad.
Hell, most of the people I watch that actually do Twitch are actually going.
Yeah, I know. I'd be curious to attend, but it falls in a very bad place for me. Not San Francisco, just like date and money-wise. From there, we'll move into anime in Japan news. Three quarters of this show are pretty good anime fans. V will take what she can get. first off is kind of an interesting piece. There's a new Miss Japan. And she's won the 2015 Miss Universe pageant.
Okay.
Her name is Ariana Miyamoto. She's an interesting looking woman. She's 20 years old, born in Japan, and is a Japanese citizen. However, there have been people criticizing her online in her own country, saying she is not Japanese enough. Take a look at the picture I just sent you.
She looks very Caucasian.
That actually looks very black.
Her mother is Japanese, and her father is an African American.
Okay, you're right. I cannot tell people's ethnicities.
Well, she's the first half-Japanese, half-black woman to complete in Miss Universe, so she's getting a lot of criticism for not being Japanese enough.
She's very pretty.
Yeah, she's a good-looking girl, but...
They really need to, you know... I'm looking for some words to describe, you know, this assholery.
Well, we've already discussed how Japan is a very xenophobic country. They don't understand outside cultures and influences and prefer not to have them if they can help it. You know, I don't see anything wrong with this, but this is just one of those things where some conservative individuals are bitching about very odd things that aren't really worth time.
You mean like Americans?
No, just the perception of their own race, basically. The woman is half Japanese, but apparently that's not enough for her detractors.
Sit and rotate. I have no good things to say about these detractors right now.
Okay, well, you may have the same response to the next story I'm about to read. Producers Gianni Nannari and Mark Canton and writer Michael Gordon, who worked on 300 and G.I. Joe Rise of Cobra, were working on a Robotech movie.
Yeah.
Well, now Sony is backing the project, and the word is that they're not just making a movie. Sony is angling for this to be a full franchise of films.
Yeah, I heard about that.
I am excited, but at the same time a little bit worried. When you have the guy who wrote 300 and G.I. Joe Rise of Cobra as your primary writer, you're scaring me.
Oh, I'm excited they're bringing Robotech to modern times, but at the same time, I am scared because I've seen what has happened to some remakes. You know, G.I. Joe and Transformers, you know, counting in that.
How about Battleship?
I haven't seen Battleship.
Oh, don't try. I watched about 10 minutes, and the AC/DC track and a bunch of old farts running a boat was just like, okay, you've officially pushed my suspension of disbelief beyond maximum.
And that was disappointing. That had a huge cast of actors in it.
I know. What I was disappointed, that's another story. It's been announced that they're making a new series out of Steins Gate. Steins Gate is part of a series of anime stories that are very loosely connected to each other. When I say very loosely, like maybe one or two threads connect between the series. Threads connect the series. Steins Gate is the second of those series, and it's receiving a sequel in the form of Steins Gate Zero, which is supposed to be a true sequel for the franchise being developed by Chiyomaru Shikura. fans of the anime and visual novel are apparently already happy because they've, they heard about the series and they're excited about what it's going to bring. I have watched the series. It's very stirring. Although it's one of those things that's hard to recommend to fans in general because it's not genre specific. It's mainly a drama. They have announced a live-action miniseries for Shingeki no Kyojin, or Attack on Titan. The miniseries is going to be three separate parts and takes place within the same continuity and universe as a live-action movie, which is coming out. It's not the same protagonist, though. The main star is not the character of Eren. It's going to be a character named Hange Zoe. It's being directed by Shinji Higuchi, who directed the live-action movie. Man, that is just not a series I'm a fan of. There's a lot of people that live and die by Attack on Titan. I can't get into it.
Certainly heard of it a lot.
Yeah. Now, an anime series I am a fan of is Suisei no Gargantia. It's a very interesting sci-fi tale. They had a sequel in the works. That was recently canceled entirely. The only explanation that was given by the production company was, quote, due to various circumstances, unquote. What are various circumstances? Did you lose money? Did people quit? Do your balls itch too much? What happened? And there's no word as to what happened precisely beyond various circumstances. I'm actually thoroughly disappointed in that. I was looking forward to this new series. Jesse, I take it you're not a fan of Death Note?
No.
V, I take it you probably don't know what that is.
Correct.
Death Note is kind of the ultimate emo story. There is a book called The Death Note, like a small journal. The story, as I understand it, is whoever's name you write in the journal dies.
Yeah, you can go as far as to, writing how they die. Otherwise, it's just a straight heart attack.
Like I said, it's like an emo wet dream. They're producing a musical out of this series.
Wow.
I imagine there being a lot of metal in this.
Actually, I listened to what I assume is a dress rehearsal. No. There's a lot of loud singing. It's all in Japanese, so I'm having trouble understanding it. The musical is going to feature at Tokyo's Nissei Theater until the 29th of April, and then it's going to go to Osaka and Nagoya a month later. I listened to some... No, I can't do this.
What?
I tried. I tried with an open mind, and I will share the video with you if you want a taste of it, but I don't do it willingly.
Oh, let's hear it.
Oh my god, you are a brave man.
Well,
there it is.
Serious.
Yeah, there it is. Give it a try. Death Note, the musical. It almost sounds like they were shooting for something similar to in tone of music to Phantom of the Opera, but somehow ended up closer to the Monkees.
Or Glee.
Part of that may be the language barrier, but it just sounds awfully upbeat for this kind of story. Like he's getting ready to woo the beast and, pull the rose or something.
Yeah, oh my.
Now the second actor, I don't know what role he's playing, but he sounds like he's auditioning for Newsies.
I've not seen the anime, so I may not have a leg to stand on for this, but this doesn't seem like the kind of thing I would expect to hear for Death Note. But,
I would expect something more somber, but this is very loud. This is very brash. The third tune is better, but I recognize the kid from promo images, or the character, I should say. He looks like he needs a sandwich.
You mean L? Yeah.
I'll take your word for it. I don't know.
I think that's his name. I don't know. I know I have plenty of other friends that actually watch this and say, not for me, nope.
Okay, the one playing Misa, like the one character I recognize from promos, she is very bubbly. Again, not what I would have pictured for Death Note.
Well, the main protagonist does eventually die in the series, actually.
Is it just me, or does it sound like Disco? Actually, it looks like Disco. I'm going to stop the video right here for myself, because yeah. I am just confused.
Yeah, I think I'm done too.
Now, the Japanese have some very interesting quirks when it comes to how to greet people to Tokyo. They've announced a new ambassador for the city, or actually is the new ambassador for Japan's national tourism They've announced a new national tourism ambassador for Japan, and they've put his image in Tokyo to greet people when they come off the airport. I've given you a picture as to where they placed him. Frankly, I wouldn't do this to people.
Welcome. Run.
And it is official. The new tourism ambassador of Japan is Godzilla.
And if you're not put underfoot, you'll die from the radiation.
Yeah, now that's only a head they put up there. It's 171 feet tall, and it's outside Toho, which is the studio that made the original 1954 film. Could you imagine just being a tourist, wandering around, looking up and going, "Oh shit, it's real!"
Just take a picture.
Take a picture, nothing, man. I gotta clean my shorts if that happened to me.
Now when the actual Godzilla comes, everyone's gonna think it's just some sort of tourism prank.
Oh, they got Gundams over there, too, so...
Make them fight each other?
I think Godzilla would like win.
What would that look like if you took those two mascots and started beating their heads together like an oversized pair of action figures, man? That'd be boring as shit.
Oh, Tokyo would be a fucking wasteland.
Okay, now, it's well known that sometimes American stars will do commercials for Japanese products. Yep. And because of the language and cultural barriers, those commercials sometimes turn out rather odd. I've come across a video I didn't expect to. It came really close to getting into what the fuck corner of the news.
Mm-hmm.
But how would you like to see Tommy Lee Jones doing a coffee ad for Japan?
Okay.
Curious.
Yes. It is a ton more entertaining than that Death Note musical, I swear. There it is. Like how it starts with a bunch of students look like you're getting ready to prank him. And he has eye beams! So basically, this Tommy Lee Jones has a bunch of insane powers and is just torturing kids for some reason.
He's a troll.
And apparently he's fueled by coffee. Rainbow Mountain Coffee, huh? My question is, what's with the I-beams? Tommy Lee Jones with heat vision is just frightening.
Maybe he's supposed to be an older Superman?
Certainly sounds a lot better than being Two-Face.
Oh, snap, brother. Last bit of anime in Japan news I have is kind of a fanboy wet dream. There is an all-girls school, Suruoka Kita High School in Yamagata Prefecture. They have 160 students as freshmen starting this month.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? The Japanese school year starts in April. 159 of those students are girls.
Wait. You said 150?
159 of those students. 150 of the 160 freshmen starting this month are girls. You can guess what the other one is.
It's a lucky guy there.
No, wait. Suruoka Kita High School is an all-girls school.
So how did he get in?
2 years ago, the high school changed its rules to allow boys to apply to be students. In Japan, you actually have to pass an entrance exam to get into schools. Apparently, in their first 3 years of this policy, only one male has ever managed to pass their entrance exams. That means that he may be the first male student in the freshman class, but he's also the first male student in the school. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. This young man has cracked the code and has found his way into a harem anime.
I'm not sure if that's I should be excited for him or scared for him?
Well, ever since they allowed this change in their policy, there have been male bathrooms on campus. There is a male changing lock, a male locker room on campus. Everything to support male students, but there just hasn't been one before. Now this kid is here. This kid is either the most fortunate guy on the planet, or we are going to find him 2 days from now hanging by his genitals from a tree. And at this point, I think it's a coin flip as to which way we'll find him. Certain Japanese people have been responding to this online, and the responses are, quote, I think I've read this story in a manga before, unquote. Quote, the harem fantasy is so good, but the reality is probably horrific, unquote. Quote, so that means he's stuck as the only guy in his whole class for the next 3 years. Japanese high school is 3 years long. Good luck, kid, unquote. I like this one. I love this. Quote, what bravery! I wonder if he'll last all the way to graduation, unquote.
Oh, my.
Like I said, I'm not sure whether I should be happy for this kid or scared for him, because, you know, as some harems go, there's some crazy bitches there.
You know what? All I could say is, don't flirt. My best advice, if by some miracle he's listening, don't flirt. Just perfect your grooming. It will come. That's the best advice I could give. We'll move into nerd interest news. We talk about the nerdy items in the news that don't quite fit into entertainment categories. There is the seed of a plant called the Erodium cictarium. It's called the stork's bill or fillery plant. It's an interesting one because as it seeds itself into the ground, it actually corkscrews itself into the earth. They can be launched for distances of up to 1 meter via a mechanism called ballistic dispersal. And they have an interesting GIF and time lapse of this thing actually drilling itself into the earth over the course of time.
I didn't know
plants... Wow, you get excited over the strangest shit sometimes.
I think I've heard about this plant prior at, on a Game Theorist video.
All right, well, I sent it. I mean, there you see it is definitely a seed that has an odd tail to it.
Oh, I've seen this thing before.
Yeah, you can see the time-lapse. The time-lapse is interesting. It almost looks like the seed is angling into the ground. It's actually pushing itself in.
Yeah, that's cool.
It's freaky.
Time-lapse photography is great.
It's stuff like this that makes me almost question what people consider about the sentience of plants. It looks like it actually knows what it needs to do.
I have always been...
Actually, I think I would attribute... Never mind. I was going to attribute to that little spin... that corkscrew thing losing water and dehydrating, but it's spun the other way.
No, plants can't actually move. Like, if you put a bean plant... a green bean plant somewhere, it will try to grow in the direction of the most sunlight, and it will move in that direction.
Yeah, I don't have any information as to how long this time lapse took, but it does look like the plant actually corrects its at one point in the video. It actually pulls itself out of the dirt over some time.
Yeah, I don't know how they do that, the process. But they do it.
It's got to be via this tendril it has.
They have some weird form of control over their stalks.
You know what? That means next time I eat a salad, I'm going to wonder if it's going to kill me.
You know what? I've always said that the plants just are helpless and are screaming as you pick them.
Okay, as I mull over that next time I have zucchini. there's a story that scientists have actually managed to transplant mammoth DNA into elephant cells.
Oh, that's cool.
There was an experiment by a geneticist, George Church of Harvard University. His team analyzed the DNA extracted from well-preserved mammoth remains on Wrangel Island. And they weren't able to reconstruct the DNA in its entirety, but they were able to recreate or synthesize a functional version of it in the lab. They actually managed to splice this into existing elephant cells. You know, this goes along with a theory of mine in that if we have the capability to put back some stuff we've broken, we should really do it.
Yes.
Like how we're depleting, you know, tiger and rhino populations. That's a man-made issue, and as the things causing it, we have a right to put... We have a responsibility, I should say, to put it back.
Agreed.
You know, I argued that online with one person who just said, no way, dude, it's natural selection.
It's not natural selection.
That is not natural selection.
It's not natural selection if we're depleting their environment and shooting them. There's nothing natural about that.
Except the only way that could possibly be argued is we are an agent of natural selection, which since we do come from Earth, technically, but that's semantics. But the thing is,
natural selection has to do with the environment changing to such a point due to the environment changing. Mm-hmm. Or I should say it's due to... Natural selection is the environment changing so that the habitat of the animals is impossible to maintain. Quite a difference when man moves in and starts polluting or plowing over shit and just forcing things to move.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're saying the Ice Age was the same thing as human progression.
I would argue that humans exist so far outside the circle of life, nothing we do is natural selection. But that's me. Boeing has patented a force field.
Boeing?
Yeah, Boeing, the Boeing. Military...
At first I thought you said Boeing.
You thought it was talking about force fields, and you heard boing, like it bounces off the force field. No, the aircraft company Boeing has actually patented a force field design. The system is designed not to prevent direct impact from shells or shrapnel, but is designed to protect a target, like a vehicle or building, from damaging effects of shockwaves from a nearby impact.
Nice.
So it's not exactly a full protection force field, but it would at least protect from concussion waves and things like that.
Well, actually, it's maybe...
It's not going to stop a bullet.
No, I'm saying using the term literally, it's shielding against force, you know. Never mind.
Well, this is one of those things that would be very useful for guerrilla warfare if you're trying to stop your cargo runs from being hit by IEDs, because IEDs, it's not the explosion necessarily that does a ton of damage, it's a shockwave and shrapnel. Can't stop the shrapnel, but you can at least prevent the shockwave from knocking things over.
Yeah.
So it's... I just didn't think we'd gotten that far ahead. And it's only the design phase, it's not like it's been implemented as of yet. It's a curious idea, though. Would you be interested to hear an excerpt that was posted online about a week ago from George R. R. Martin's Winds of Winter?
Sure.
It's a snippet from the beginning of a chapter that has to do with Sansa Stark playing the game of intrigue as well as anybody else. Let's see. Quote, "She was reading her little lord a tale of the winged knight when... Maya Stone came knocking on the door of his bedchamber, clad in boots and riding leathers and smelling strongly of the stable. Maya had straw in her hair and a scowl on her face. That scowl comes from having Michel Redford near, Elaine knew. Your lordship, Maya informed Lord Robert. Lady Wainwood's banners have been seen an hour down the road. She will be here soon, with your cousin Harry. Will you want to greet them? Why did she have to mention Harry, Elaine thought. We will never get sweet Robin out of bed now. The boy slapped a pillow. Send them away. I never ask them here. Maya looked nonplussed. No one in the Vale was better at handling a mule, but the lordlings were another matter. They were invited, she said uncertainly. For the tourney, I don't... Elaine closed her book. Thank you, Maya. Let me talk with Lord Robert, if you would. Relief plain on her face, Maya fled without another word. I hate that Harry, sweet Robin said when she was gone. He calls me cousin, but he's just waiting for me to die so he can take the Eyrie. He thinks I don't know, but I do. Your lordship should not believe such nonsense, Elaine said. I'm sure Sir Harold loves you well, and if the gods are good, he will love me too. Her tummy gave a little flutter. He doesn't, Lord Robert insisted. He wants my father's castle, that's all, so he pretends. The boy clutched the blanket to his pimply chest. I don't want you to marry him, Elaine. I'm the Lord of the Ear, and I forbid it. He sounded as if he were about to cry. You should marry me instead. We could sleep in the same bed every night, and you could read me stories. No man can wed me so long as my dwarf husband still lives somewhere in this world. Queen Cersei had collected the head of a dozen dwarfs, Peter claimed, but none were Tyrians. Sweet Robin, you must not say such things. You are the Lord of the Ear and Defender of the Vale, and you must wed a high-born lady and father a son to sit in the high hall of House Arryn after you are gone, unquote. That's all there is right now. Apparently this is the beginning of a chapter in the next book of The Song of Fire and Ice. However, George R. R. Martin did answer a few tough questions about the book series. He had some interesting responses. One of the questions was, what was the thing that made you realize in the middle of the first novel that it had to be more of a trilogy? His response was, quote, it was quite at the end. It was by 95 that I realized it had to be more than a trilogy because I had 1,500 pages of manuscript and I wasn't anywhere close to the end of the first book. So I said, I know, I can get all this into three books here. I'm going to have to break this first book into two books and get it all done, which required a certain amount of restructuring, but I went back and I did that. I took out about 300 pages or so, and that became the beginning of the second book, and I moved things around, unquote. Has he really been writing this for like 20 frickin' years?
That wouldn't surprise me. It's something like that requires a lot of work.
Well, another question they asked him was, you've had these characters and places for 22 years, and that's a long time to live with a particular set of characters. So have you lost interest in any of those characters during that time? His response was, quote, you know, not really, because I haven't finished the story I want to tell. The story I set out to tell in 1991 is still not done. I think if I finally finish these seven books, or however many it takes, I will be tired of them. I will not necessarily be open to returning to tell more stories about the ones who survived after the end. There you run into a Sherlock Holmes Reichenbach Falls sort of thing, where the writer says, I'm sick of Sherlock Holmes. I never want to write any more stories about him. But I haven't even finished a single story. As many books as it is, as many words as it is, it's still one story. One story that's not finished yet. I want to finish telling that story. And then I'll worry about that, unquote. We'll post a link to the entire story that we got off IO9. Looks like somebody asked him about a dozen to 20 questions, and he answered all of them.
You know, I don't feel so bad that I'm, you know, just starting to write my stories after a year of putting it all together.
Yeah, but no, keep in mind, thinking about this, after he sold a TV series and is working on all kinds of other stuff, you know, his success came before the books were done.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, I found out today that 4 episodes of the 5th season of Game of Thrones have already been leaked online somehow.
Really?
Yeah, nearly half of the next season of Game of Thrones is already online on torrent sites. That's got to be pissing people off. So if you hate spoilers, don't touch the internet for about 4 weeks. I do have something that Dorkly.com put up in Nerd Interest News. 20 of what they call the cosplays that are so accurate, you'll involuntarily poop your pants. That's the name they gave it.
Okay.
I flipped through it. These are some really good cosplays. Take a look at the URL I sent you. I mean, the first one is a frighteningly good Ariel.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Although the next one of the 11th Doctor, he doesn't have Matt Smith's like prominent jawline, but he comes pretty close.
Right?
Even has the same kind of gaze.
Even his body language is similar.
Yeah, he did a good job. It looks like the cosplayer is called Matt 11. The Elizabeth from Bioshock Infinite looks pretty good, too.
Wow.
Those are some heavily sculpted eyebrows. Now, real-life Peter Griffin, I've seen him all over the internet.
Oh, yeah.
Nebula. The Nebula face is not...
It's pretty good, though. Somebody really committed to a lot of work there.
Oh, click the next page. Tyler.
I know, she looks the part almost entirely. The only problem is the roots. At least I believe those are roots.
Who is that supposed to be?
Who? Rose Tyler was the companion introduced in Doctor Who, Christopher Eccleston.
Oh, okay, now, okay. I see it.
Yeah, Witcher 2 I don't have context for, but that's...
Costume,
yeah, cool. No, that definitely looks like the character from the game.
Oh, the costume has an insane amount of detail, though.
I'm not as sure about the Xena.
I actually like it quite a bit. She doesn't have the same kind of body structure,
Her
face is really close.
That's true.
Ah, damn.
Yeah, the hero in Tadashi from Big Hero 6, that's a pretty good look.
I just saw that the other day.
Ah!
And the brother.
Yeah, the Dana Scully, some generic. Good and some bad about it.
Yeah.
The next page starts off with Korra from Legend of Korra.
Well, that's a good Margaery.
Oh, yeah. Looks a lot like the actress. Who is that? Santa Tori.
Kaylee. That's a really good Kaylee.
Yeah.
That's a cosplay for Hermione?
Yeah, that is a cosplayer named Lavi AV.
Dude, that's freaking...
What about her in the casual clothes underneath?
Yeah, that's...
Now, if you want scary, scroll down to Patrick Bateman.
That isn't Christian Bale?
No, it's not. It's a cosplayer named Spark94. He looks just like him, though.
I can see the difference now. I'm looking at him closely, but...
Yeah, the next page is Miles Morales, the Ultimate Spider-Man.
Wow. Yeah.
That's a good context on that one. Dwight, I've seen pictures of.
Yeah, Dwight from The Office. That's frighteningly close to Rainn Wilson. I don't know who Toriel is.
Good question. Yep.
Skip that. Scroll down to the Rick Grimes cosplayer.
Oh, Lord of the Rings. Rick Grimes.
That's Look at that good. Face.
Yeah, that's so good. Elsa and Anna.
That's a good looking pair of sisters. Anna and Lexi Carlson.
Elsa's not as...
I always think that animated, especially Disney character cosplays, have got to be so difficult because there's so many fine details in there, and the faces would be almost impossible to replicate.
Mm-hmm.
You're never going to please everybody with that. Last bit of nerd interest news I have is a man who is both a genius and insane. I expect to find him ruling the world via a volcano top lair pretty soon.
Well, for a second, I thought you were describing Batman.
No. There is a... There's a group of biohackers, one of which took an injection of chemical chlorophyll analog chlorine E6, or CE6, to his eyes to create temporary night vision.
Okay.
I shit you not. They injected this solution into one of the biohackers' eyes to create temporary biological night vision in his eyes.
Nice.
You are a very brave man, but what the fuck is wrong with you?
Right? Yeah, I would not...
Well, take a look. Here's a picture of the guy who had after post-injection of the solutions.
Whoa!
Easy, brother! Jeez!
So now he looks like a vampire.
Soulless. No, he's soulless.
Did vampire not cover that?
I don't know. The face almost looks like, and now I can see what you look like in the dark, if it were dark.
Now all he needs is red contacts, and he'll look like Gambit.
Red contacts, dude, and I'm leaving. You know, I applaud the step they've taken, you know, if they're able to create chemical night vision and everything, but at the same time, something tells me none of you are doctors.
Right.
So I don't know how to further go through that story. Last group of stories we'll go through is our What the Fuck Corner. We talk about those stories that just really make us wonder what is going on this planet. The first one is kind of a positive. There's a group of British musicians. They have a band they call Tesseract. They've entered the Guinness Book of World Records. Tesseract is now in the Guinness Book of World Records because they're the first ones to play a set on a stage made entirely of ice.
Huh.
They were what? On part
of... A stage of ice?
Yes, they were a part of Jägermeister's Ice Cold series of gigs, and they played at the Snow Village in Kittila, Lapland. They played on a stage that was entirely man-made, built from 20 million kilograms of snow and 350,000 kilograms of crystal clear natural ice. It covered 20,000 square meters.
Wow.
They actually played on ice. I have a YouTube video, it's about 2 minutes long, of them actually playing on the stage.
Sure.
You curious?
Sure.
There it is. I like how the video starts somewhere ice cold. No shit.
We're Tesseract from the UK. We've just arrived in Lapland, Finland. We're here for the Jägermeister Ice Cold gig, and we're about to meet our taxi driver.
You know, the funny thing is, I've never seen a British rock band before, but this looks almost exactly like I would envision, frankly.
Go here. It feels like another world. It feels alien. I've never seen anything like it.
Now, where is Lapland? Is that in Iceland?
I think to be here, we are just extremely... The Lapland?
No.
I don't know.
Get through this kind of stuff. Yeah, there's a band. I'm very bad with European geography. I don't know where Lapland is.
Lapland?
I'm sure right now somebody like Roger Heisman is just yelling at me about where it is, and I'm completely lost.
Finland.
Oh, okay.
Finland.
Is that an ice hotel? Whoa.
That's cool.
No, that's the igloo.
Place.
Yeah.
Jesus. Oh, there they are building the stage. Oh, man, if you built a stage out of crystal clear ice and put some LEDs under it...
Oh.
And you know half your crowd... Yeah, you know half your crowd is probably high to begin with, so they're going to freak the fuck out. And it does look like they underlit it. Oh, wow.
That was the best way to light this place.
All of a sudden, I want to go see a rock band in Lapland. This looks awesome.
I'm moving to Finland.
It's not every day you get to do something as... Actually, music's pretty good, too. That's nice metal. The coldest,
the most I like it.
Show. It's the most unexpected,
superb life experience, and I'll never forget it.
It is hard to describe, but they've got all kinds... It looks like they put a bunch of spotlights in between layers of ice. That's awesome.
Here's the thing. You need a smoke machine.
I know.
Just the heat of the lamps are just enough to cause steam.
That's perfect. The problem is you couldn't keep those lamps lit all the time, otherwise you might end up sinking through the stage.
Right.
Now we have a story that definitely ended up in what the fuck territory, but unfortunately it's a real story.
Oh boy.
We appear to be hitting that age where some of the stuff that we've seen when we were kids is just getting rebooted. You know, people occasionally run out of stories and they feel like rewriting something that's came before it, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Fox is now greenlit a reboot of the Rocky Horror Picture Show.
I've heard of this.
I have not seen this.
It's going to be a two-hour TV movie choreographed by Kenny Ortega. Kenny Ortega's big credits are High School Musical and Xanadu.
Alright, this is doomed for failure already.
Yeah, I need a ripcord. Somebody give me a ripcord because I got to pull it. I'm not a fan of the original Rocky Horror Picture Show.
I'm not either.
You put somebody like that behind it, I'm through. I'm out. Not happening. God damn it, that hurts me in sensitive places. Now, there are reasons why I've never gone to Africa. Despite being black, it's just not a place I feel like I fit in. If I ever find a guide like this, I would shit myself and probably be eaten by lions.
Oh, this one.
There was a safari guide on a walking tour with a bunch of people in South Africa, okay? He apparently found a group of people that wouldn't take his instructions. More specifically, part of this group was a German tourist who was ignoring the instructions and was wandering towards a bush off the trail where a dangerous animal was believed to be. You actually hear in a video that was submitted a growl that sounds kind of like a lion. And the guide said, quote, "I'm being very serious. There is no fence between you and the animals, okay? You guys stick together, even if something charges out of the bushes at any moment." The video cuts out and comes back into an irate guide yelling in English and Afrikaans, quote, "There is a huge animal in the fucking bush. Shut up. Keep quiet. Stay there." And finally, the guy just said, "They're going to bring a jeep for you. Stay here." And he walked away.
Wow.
I mean, how much would you really have to piss a guy off who spends all of his time around dangerous animals and he says, "You know what? Fuck you. Deal with them."
This might have been just the last straw.
I could only imagine what would happen when they got back to whatever outpost there was if he was just sitting at the bar downing shit and he said, "Ah, you all made it." You know, fuck, man, if I was on a walking tour in Africa, the first thing I would do is not piss off my guide.
Right? That seems like going to Africa 101.
Yeah, that's usually what happens.
Next thing, don't wander toward the bushes.
I mean, this is, frankly, when you start pissing off your guide, that's how shit like Jurassic Park happens, you know? Okay, next off in our What the Fuck corner. There was an interesting natural formation that happened as a result of a Nevada farmer drilling for water. Have you heard of a fly geyser?
No.
Okay, a fly geyser is some kind of bizarre, like, mini geyser that ends up spitting out mud and minerals. Here, I'm going to give this to you in a small series of pictures. According to the story, this is what the original drilling for water look like? It doesn't look like much, right?
Yeah. Seen this one.
Okay. They had two failures of drilling for water. And then, after a few days of drilling, they come back, and this is what they find.
Whoa! That's pretty.
Yeah, high water pressure ends up pushing up minerals and gas. It evolves into a pile of stone, rock, and minerals that is just rainbow-colored and awesome, and it just keeps pushing.
How long does this take?
I'm not very clear on the time frame, but apparently water ponds have formed their own ecosystems around the Fly Geyser. Take a look at the next URL I sent you. This looks like something out of Avatar, frankly.
I don't
care if you mean like Avatar The Last Airbender or Blue Rabbit People Avatar. This looks like something straight out of there.
This looks cool.
Dude, he should just, you know, put up a fence and start selling tickets.
That's the thing, is that several people have offered to buy the land since then and make it available for tourists, but the owners have refused to sell. The property's still private.
Damn.
Now, the landlord will guide tourists around to visit the area, but first you have to get in contact with them to get in. The prices for guided tours vary from time to time. You can read more about it on the website for Fly Ranch Project. Dude, as a sense of scale, here's a couple people outside of it, including a couple on a ladder. It's not a huge formation, but I would like to see this.
Yeah.
Where is it? That'd be really cool. Where is
it's
this
in Nevada.
Again? Oh, okay.
Nevada?
Mm-hmm.
It's not one of the states you refuse to go to.
Yeah, it's not terribly far from here. Yeah, maybe you can catch a bus back from Comic-Con and tell us what it's like.
Let's see.
I have, according to Kotaku, a list of 10 video games that got weird name changes in other countries.
Video games, okay.
Yeah, video games that got name changes due to the rules in other countries. Does anybody remember a PS2 game called Bully?
Yeah.
No.
Okay, it was a game where you're literally playing the bully, the antagonist, or the primary character you play is a bully in a school. In the UK, it was retitled to Canis Canum Edit.
Okay.
The reason, according to the story, the reason for that is, quote, Bully, a game about high school life that was presumed prior to release to be all about, well, bullying, attracted a lot of controversy in both the US and Europe. In the UK specifically, where Rockstar changed Bully's title to Canis Canum Edit, anti-bullying organizations campaigned against the game's release, and even the country's rating board came under fire for giving it a 15 rating. Strangely, the game's updated version for the 360 and the Wii, Bully Scholarship Edition, was allowed to keep the Bully title when it came out 2 years later. It still caused controversy, though, unquote. I can see why people would have a problem with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree.
This next one confuses me very greatly. Contra got a name change.
Really?
Okay.
Yeah. In Europe and Oceania, it was called Grisor the Probotector. That sounds like awful Swedish porn, frankly. The reason, quote, Contra, specifically the first arcade game, came to PAL regions as Grisor, and nobody knows the exact reason why. One theory posits it was to avoid referencing the Iran-Contra affair, a political scandal from the late 80s. The later games were renamed for wholly different reasons, to get around German censorship laws. The game's human cast and some of its alien enemies had been redrawn to look like robots. The new title, the Probotector, meaning Robot Protector, reflected that. The first uncensored PAL-Contra game to come out was Legacy of War in 1996, which was released with the Contra title intact, unquote.
Hmm.
The next game I've never heard of, Elebit?
Nope. Me neither.
In Europe and Oceania, it was known as Elades. The reason for that is, quote, Elebits was a series of games from Konami that featured the titular electricity-based creatures. The publisher never gave an official reason for the rename, but some speculated it was for a pun. LEDs. LEDs. Get it? While others thought it was to avoid lewd jokes about bits, unquote.
Okay.
How about this? Metal Gear Ghost Babel got a rename. In Japan, it was called Metal Gear Solid. Oh, no, I'm sorry, I have that backwards. Outside of Japan, the game was renamed Metal Gear Solid.
Huh.
The reason, quote, Ghost Babel was originally commissioned by Konami as a port of Metal Gear Solid to the Game Boy Color. However, it ended up a completely different game, a non-canon follow-up to Kojima's first Metal Gear on the MSX2. its story taking place 7 years after that of the game's events. But the Metal Gear Solid name was kept anyway for, according to Metal Gear fan site Snake Soup, marketing purposes, unquote. That sounds simple, but complicated.
That's the same logic between with Batman Assault on Arkham.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I follow that. Well, Mortal Kombat game got a name change. Mortal Kombat Deception. In France, it was called Mortal Kombat Mystification. The reason for that is, quote, in summer of 2004, there were rumors that the latest Mortal Kombat game, subtitled Deception, would get a name change in France. Initially, then-publisher Midway Games denied these rumors, but they eventually confirmed that the game would be renamed to Mortal Kombat Mystification. So why the change? Midway cited translation issues, and Google Translate reveals that in French, Deception translates to disappointment, frustration, and letdown. So, yeah, understandable, unquote.
Okay.
Wouldn't that suck if you put out a game called Mortal Kombat Disappointment?
Do I buy this game now?
I don't know. I think that's what they called Mortal Kombat versus DC.
Oh.
Ah!
You bought that, didn't you?
Nope.
No?
Nope, never touched it. Hmm. Never touched it. We already know the story behind this one. Pac-Man? Hmm? You don't know that Pac-Man was a name change?
No.
I think I've heard about that
you
before.
If you've ever watched Scott Pilgrim, you should know this story.
The original title.
Okay. The original title, Pac-Man, was Puck-Man. The reason for that was, quote, Toru Iwatani, the developer of Pac-Man, originally named his game Pac-Man, based on the Japanese onomatopoeia for the sound of a mouth opening and closing. Paku, 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 paku. This was romanized to Puck-Man, a name which did end up on the very first arcade machines, including the ones at the game's first location test in May of 1980. Later, when the game's publisher Namco was laying down the plans to bring Puck-Man West, Midway, the American distributor, noted that the machines could easily be vandalized to say fuck instead of puck. Namco decided to change the name to Pac-Man, which is still a correct romanization of Pac-Man, putting that on later machines, unquote.
Okay, someone thought ahead.
Yeah, someone actually beat us to the punch. Ratchet and Clank got name changes.
Really?
Yeah, nearly every Ratchet and Clank sequel got a different name in Europe and Oceania. The reason for that is, quote, in some cases it's clear, Ratchet and Clank, Going Commando, and Up Your Arsenal got renamed to Ratchet and Clank 2, Locked and Loaded, and Ratchet and Clank 3, respectively, to get rid of the innuendo in the names. But at the same time, Ratchet and Clank Size Matters, arguably the most innuendo-y of the bunch, did not get a different name in Europe, while Full Frontal Assault did, Ratchet and Clank Q-Force. And then there are seemingly random changes. Ratchet Deadlocked got changed to Ratchet Gladiator, and the Ratchet and Clank Future series had the Future subtitle removed from all three games in PAL regions for some reason. Unquote.
I think some of the reasoning for one of those titles is it's a indicator of violence, the same reason why they renamed Ninja Turtles over there.
Oh, yeah, that's actually the next up here. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles got a name change. You know what that name change was?
Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles?
Yes, that's exactly it. That's what it was changed to in European countries.
Yep.
The reason for that was censorship. Quote, in some parts of Europe, ninja were considered a taboo subject, and so, in a couple places, the TMNT franchise was renamed to Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles. The video games weren't edited beyond their titles, but the TV show was hit harder. Mm-hmm. For example, in the UK, Michelangelo's nunchaku were edited out completely and replaced with a grappling hook beyond season 3. Another high-profile victim of the ninja controversy was Ninja Gaiden, which had its first few games renamed to Shadow Warriors in parts of Europe, unquote. I didn't know ninjas were such a bad thing outside Japan.
Oh, they've lightened up on it as of recently, but back in the 90s, that was a huge deal. All
right, well, there's a couple more here, but I'm going to go ahead and skip that for now. Now, this is a... What?
I was saying, I'm surprised, Mega Man wasn't on that list.
Well, I couldn't say much about that, but I do have a question I want you guys to answer honestly, and I mean both of you.
All right.
V, you too.
Mute.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
Hey. There we go.
Yeah. Okay, so the question I want to ask is, have you ever taken a shit so vile it cleared a room?
Including myself? Yes. No, that was a fart, not a shit.
V, what about you?
The room that I was in was my... I was the only one in it, so I guess yes.
Oh, that's cheating. The reason why I asked was because someone took a shit that was so bad, a British Airways plane had to turn around.
Wow.
Oh. That's vile.
I don't know if I would be horrified or proud that I made a plane land because of my shit. Now, there was a British Airways flight from Heathrow to Dubai on a Saturday that had to turn around at Heathrow just 30 minutes into a 7-hour flight. according to one individual who happened to be on the flight and was tweeting, he said, quote, insane, our British Airways flight to Dubai returned back to Heathrow because of a smelly poo in the toilet. 15 hours until next flight, unquote.
Jesus. I hope there's something medically wrong with that person.
Quote, the pilot made an announcement requesting senior cabin crew, and we knew something was a bit odd. About 10 minutes later, he said, you may have noticed there's a quite pungent smell coming from one of the toilets. He said it was liquid fecal excrement. Those are the words he used. Quote.
Oh.
Wow.
Wow.
Gross.
Oh my god. How could it be liquid shit that was that bad? Didn't he flush?
Depends on how explosive it was.
Oh my god.
Oh. I don't even want to think about that.
You think he spackled the bathroom?
Oh. I wasn't going there. Damn.
Okay. All right, we'll go from the horrific, we'll go from the vile to the horrific, actually. There is a veteran Counter-Strike player from Denmark. His name is Anders Christian Johansen. He's known as Rulox. R-U-L-L-O-X. He survived having his throat slashed.
Literally?
Literally. According to the Daily Dot, he was a former member of the Viborg Vipers. He's no longer a top-level player today. He was trying to intervene in an argument between a young man and a woman at a club over last weekend. He stepped in when he saw the young woman was pushed into some tables and chairs. You know, he was being gallant, I guess you could say.
Yeah.
And after helping her up, the person that she was arguing with, who was 18 years old, pulled out a knife and slashed Johansson's throat before fleeing.
Ugh.
Here's the part that's metal. Johansson was so angry about being cut that he chased after the guy. Two bouncers saw him run out onto the street with blood spewing from his throat, and that's when they stopped him and showed him that something was wrong, and they called emergency services. If the cut was 2 millimeters deeper, they would have hit a major artery.
And if they let him chase that guy down, he probably would have bled out.
No, if you want to know how close he came to dying, take a look at what I just sent you.
Oh.
Wow.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah, he's gonna talk funny for a while, but yeah, I think he damn
near
came close
to an artery. Well, no, like I said, he didn't even notice he was cut until somebody stopped him. So
that was a sharp blade.
I don't think that whoever this guy was hit anything major. It's probably all skin that he cut through, maybe a little bit of muscle. Mm-hmm. But it's almost an ear-to-ear cut, frankly. And you know what? Power to you, dude. You did the right thing. It cost you, but at the same time, you are fucking metal. I swear, dude, you get a cut like that and don't notice it, you're either high on adrenaline or you are just the toughest bastard I ever met.
No, that's probably a sharp-ass knife.
Dude, this is some Chuck Norris bullshit, frankly. Now, this made into what the fuck, but it's kind of a positive one. Do you remember when we talked a little while ago about the Spider-Woman controversy with Milo Manara?
Yeah, kind of.
The Spider-Woman pose. Do you remember that cover?
Yeah.
It was an alternate cover where a lot of people said she was too sexy for the cover. And Marvel ended up yanking it just to stop the acrimony. And we talked about it on the show. We didn't think it was over-sexualized. We just thought it was a woman in a Spider-Man-esque pose, if you recall. Well, Frank Cho is a noted Marvel artist. He's done some interiors for them. I think he's done some new Avengers. He normally does covers for them these days because he admits he's a slow artist. he has his own blog that's not controlled by Marvel, and he created a he put up an image on his blog, and he made this. He took the character of Spider-Gwen and put her in the exact same pose. Along with a little bit of humor to go with it, with Spider-Man poking his head over the side of the building and going, woohoo. Mm-hmm. It's an interesting picture. I don't even think it's quite as sexualized as the Spider-Woman picture, really, because of the funny smile she's got.
Yeah.
But he got a lot of flack online from the Mary Sue. The Mary Sue is a known women's issues website. And one of their writers, Sam Max, took issue with an article that was titled, "Just Because You Can Doesn't Mean You Should." She said in the article, quote, "Here's the thing. Yes, Cho has always drawn some cheesecake stuff, and there will always be a place for that in comics. It's why we don't write daily articles about stuff like this and this. But by taking this shot at this particular cover, one that caused so much discomfort among lots of comic book readers, it shows a clear disregard for the perfectly valid outrage over Manara's original Spider-Woman variant. An incident that, we should note, made our list of the worst moments in female fandom in 2014. Aside from being an obvious poke at those angry feminists who overreact to things, the cover is also an unfortunate but elucidating look at what some men think about women who are trying to carve out a space for themselves in the frequently misogynistic world of comics, where they feel objectified and overly sexualized on a regular basis. What makes this sketch even more inappropriate is that the Spider-Gwen book is clearly aimed at a teen audience, meant to entice new, younger female readers to Marvel Comics. Plus, Gwen herself is a teenager," unquote.
Hmm.
Now, my plain reaction to that is, way to over-fucking react to one guy's art blog.
Right.
You know, it's not like you drew her with any missing clothes. Her costume is still perfectly intact, frankly. And as we discussed before, you know, Spider-Man himself has been known to slink over buildings, but just because this is a woman, suddenly it's over-sexualized. I still don't think this pose is out of the realm of possibility for anybody in the Spider-Man family of characters.
Yeah, even Spider-Man's probably done this too.
Okay, here's the funny part. Cho himself heard the acrimony, and he responded on his own blog. He said, quote, "Wow, what a crazy couple of days it's been. My parody cover sketch of Spider-Gwen aping the famous Manara Spider-Woman pose sent some of the hypersensitive people in a tizzy. To be honest, I was amused and surprised by the uproar, since it was, in my opinion, over nothing. It's essentially a small group of angry and humorless people ranting against my drawing of a pretty woman. It's utter nonsense. This world would be a better and happier place if some people would just grow a sense of humor and relax. Now I'm getting bombarded by various bloggers asking for an interview addressing this scandal. Instead of me wasting my breath and my precious time over this non-issue, replying to all the interviews, I've drawn another cover sketch in response, which will hopefully answer all the questions. Enjoy, everybody." This is a sketch he sent.
Yeah.
That's great.
Now he gave him something to bitch about.
Yeah. The reason why they're laughing is because he went outside the Spider family and recreated the sketch again with a new 52 version of Harley Quinn. You know, if there was a point where you could call it sexual, all of a sudden one of the non-Spiders doing this, now you've got an argument, frankly.
But at the same time,
he's not trying to create an argument. I think this is just his visual version of "fuck you and your problems."
I think our biggest complaint, or at least mine was, of the original Spider-Woman pose was it doesn't feel right. It doesn't seem like it's anatomically correct.
It's the shoulders that always bothered me. But again, he's not doing it from his own art catalog. He's making fun of the Milo Manara version. So he's got to keep a lot of aspects of the pose intact. I feel the same way he does. I think this is a few angry people making an issue out of something that isn't an issue.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I got to ask you guys. Do you remember when we had a what the fuck about a month and a half ago of a man who took a picture just before a gorilla was about to punch the shit out of him?
Yeah.
I don't know where these people exist, but I've got another one. There's a Pakistani nature photographer named Atif Saeed. He caught a shot of a creature that definitely knew he was there. And if I saw this, photos would be the least of my problems. Take a look at this picture.
Oh. Okay.
Oh my god.
I think the line is giving him a warning. Get the fuck out.
This is definitely a male lion who has spotted you and is not amused. It looks like he's about to give you a Kanye West-style rant for taking his photo, frankly. And it's not just a lion staring straight down the lens. This is a lion, like, baring teeth and jaws and just saying, I'm gonna fuck you up. And do you want to know what's worse? The guy was too stupid to move. And I don't mean he lived. I mean he stuck around for this.
Oh my god. Did he live?
Yes, he did.
What happened?
Now let me see. Atif took this at a safari park zoo near Lahore. He got out of his jeep to take the photo, but the sound of the lens whizzing caught the lion's attention. Saheed figures the big cat got as close as 10 feet before he was able to reach the safety of his jeep. 10 feet is not much room. Not as fast as a lion runs. And the story on IO9 goes on to say, once safely inside his vehicle, Saheed started to laugh about what had happened. But after some retrospection, he came to realize just how close he came to death. And vowed to never do anything quite as reckless again.
Well, at least he learned his lesson.
You know what? I would have learned my lesson a long time ago, because I can tell you, judging by this photo, this lion has about 14 front teeth, and that's too much information for me. You know, that's the point where I know I'm too close. Last bit of what the fuck news I have is a list of 10 places. A list of 10 places you will try to have sex and why it will actually suck, according to collegehumor.com.
Okay.
This should be good.
Okay. Do you want to read it, V? I think you should read this. I think we need a female voice on this, because I read one that was not in my... wasn't in proper context. I want to see what it sounds like when you do it.
Oh, God.
I think I'm going to enjoy this experiment.
Okay. 10 places you'll try to have sex and why it will actually suck. 1.
Yes.
Pool. Who sings that R&B song that's like, ooh, sexy lady, you make me so hot, let's do in a cement container of children's urine?
Whoa.
Trick question. There isn't one because gross. Even if you somehow found a relatively pee-free and private pool to get nude in, it's weirdly difficult to have sexual intercourse underwater. You can't get any traction. You know, I think I tried that once. Plus, I hear the chlorine turns your pubes green. Yeah.
I have not attempted sex in a pool. I think I've come close, but we decided to move to other places.
Number two.
And I'm not.
Sorry, go on.
I was just going to say, I'm not going to admit to who that was, because then it would date stamp it and I'm going to get a lecture.
All right, 2, shower. Does somebody have to read this? Oh my god.
Yes!
Babe, you know what would be even hotter than kissing normally? Doing it through a torrential stream of water so we can't even breathe even a little bit. And while we're basically waterboarding ourselves that way, let's also try to maneuver into an impossible standing sex position while poised on an extremely slippery surface. Who needs lube when you've got Mountain Spring scented 2-in-1 hair product for men? Will we both fall and crack our skulls open, spilling our brains onto the slick tiled floor? Maybe. The danger is what makes it so sexy.
Oh, I will say this, V, you make danger sound hot.
All right, number 3.
Has anybody tried sex in a shower?
Yeah, but not in the manner they're talking about.
I've tried it. Awkward is the best way I would put it.
Yeah.
It is one of those things where unless you have like one of those granny-style bath mats, foot placement is very important.
Yeah. And one of those nose-slip thingies.
Yes.
All right, 3. The ground outside. Think about all the bugs that are outside that are so small you can't even see them. Now think about them crawling inside your genitalia. Are you feeling turned on yet?
You sound horrified just reading that.
A little bit.
I remember playing tackle football before there was grass in my parents' yard. We laughed so hard, we stayed there for a bit and got back up and realized that my crotch was itching. Apparently I landed on a red ant hill.
Ooh.
Oh! Okay, I'm really glad you finished that sentence, because these, when we're talking about this, about sex outside, and suddenly the phrase starts with, we play tackle football outside my grandma's house, it's like, wow, this story is going to take a turn. And then you say you got up and your crotch started itching. Wait, you did a tackle and got herpes? What happened?
No, I was still like, what, 10 when that happened, so... Uh-huh.
Context. Okay, we need to move on because I'm about to say the wrong things here, okay. Man. This is getting
number
weird.
4, bath.
Oh, yeah. My dick has never been so relaxed. Your muscles super relaxed, too? Nice. Now let's tense ourselves the fuck up and do this before the water gets even lukewarmier.
The second part. I just orgasmed 7 times after the faucet clanged into my lower spine, but I'm just getting warmed up.
Now, if you cut that right...
That's true. Okay.
That's true. It's just, sex in a bathtub, I have done that once, and most bathtubs are not made for somebody with my size of shoulders or stomach.
I honestly can't remember if I have.
Okay, number 5 I have not done at all, because as hot as that sounds, it's also insane.
You want me to keep going, or?
Do you want to split duties with me?
You can go ahead if you want.
All right. In the rain. Quote, having sex in the rain is like having sex outside. See above reasons for why you shouldn't do that. Combined with having sex in the shower. See further above for reasons why you shouldn't do that. Oh, except for it's also 1,000 times colder than either of those things. If you have sex in the rain, you will get bronchitis, and no one will want to have sex with you even again because of all the phlegm you're hacking up. Unquote. There's something in movies that makes that ultra appealing, but there's something in real life that makes that stupid. I'll tell you what, I'll do one more and then I'm going to trade back to you, V. Sound good?
Okay.
Okay. And I have tried this. Item number 6 of 10 places you'll try to have sex and why it will actually suck. On collegehumor.com, the backseat of a car. Quote, so retro. Just park the old Chevy up at Finger Blaster's Peak and take off your leather jacket, slide that hand up her hoop skirt, and go to town! Wait, this isn't comfortable at all, and all the papers and bottles and shit on the floor of my car that I usually ignore are now filthily jamming into our naked bodies. Maybe this wasn't the best idea. Anyway, off to the malt shop, then we're hitting up the segregated sock hop. Other things that no longer happen, but for varyingly equal reasons.
Yeah, I tried that. Quote,
sock ops?
No, the back seat.
It's another one of those things that sounds incredible. Movies make it look so good and everything, but when you actually get there...
It's awkward.
At best, you're pushing the front seat out of the way.
Okay.
At best.
Number 7. Top bunk bed.
I have never tried this. This sounds horrific.
Nothing kills the mood like abruptly stopping foreplay to climb up a wooden ladder to get to your lofted bed while trying to block out the unflattering angle of your lover's butt looming above you as they climb up ahead of you. And once you're up there, forget about having any room to move around at all. You'll be doing it in one position only, and that position is both lying as flat as you possibly can so you don't hit your head on the ceiling painfully.
Question? Would you even take somebody back to your place if you were sharing a bunk bed with anybody?
I was going to point that out.
You know what? If I owned a bunk bed and I was dating, we're going to your place. You know, you're not even going to see where I live. No way.
I think I'm going to not comment on this.
Wait.
I have Wait. Had sex on the top bunk when someone was sleeping below, but it was a very weird situation.
No, expand. I'm not, like, looking for hot stories. I am, like, mortally curious right now.
We were all really drunk, and this was a long time ago.
Uh-huh.
And, I had been kind of an exhibitionist at that point in time.
Okay.
So my... Yeah.
You know the story is good when it starts, we were all drunk.
here's the one question I want to ask.
And this was kind of a thing, so...
Okay. My only question that I want to ask, and you can answer this honestly because it doesn't involve any stupid questions. Did the person in the bunk below you actually stay asleep during the entirety?
You know, I never actually asked him.
You know, I think it's a possibility, only because I slept through a 16-man Halo party. I'm not kidding. No,
I understand it's a possibility, but I'm one of those people that even when I'm tired, my brain will suddenly awake to the sound of... Because bunk beds, especially top bunks, are not exactly silent.
No.
I'd be worried about if there was a crack.
I would be worried about more than a crack.
Yeah. If that fell, there could be some injuries.
Forget fell. It's not like top bunks are watertight. I'd need to move.
Uh-oh.
Let's move on before we thoroughly embarrass ourselves.
Number 8, the beach. Getting interrupted mid-coitus by a 22-year-old beach patrolman on a 3-wheel bike may not sound sexy, but don't forget, you'll also have sand in your clothes, your every orifice, and deep within your soul for the rest of your life.
You know, that does kind of ruin that fantasy, the idea of not only getting caught by a beach patrolman, but what's your next move after you're done? Okay, baby, now wash out my crack.
All right.
I live by the beach, so...
Number 9. Pretty much any public place. Doing it in the library stacks or an empty stairwell may sound sexy because it's against the rules and you can be caught at any moment and ooh. But in real life, like, do you actually want to be caught having sex? That would be very, very embarrassing. And you'd probably have to stop having sex right when it's getting good. Honestly, why do you need to add more drama and sexiness to this act? It's already sex. Just relax.
Yeah, this is kind of bursting a lot of those preconceived bubbles that the media feeds us about sex, but it's all unfortunately very plausible.
I have no interest in sex in a public place because, I wouldn't want to get caught because that would be...
I have interest in that in limited degrees, and when I say limited, I wouldn't... I guess I would say if I was having sex in, like, a hotel room on... You know, like 6 floors up, I wouldn't be the first to close the window. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
Or I should say draw the blinds. But, you know, just like ramming somebody up against the side of a library stack of books.
No.
Sounds interesting, but at the same time, it sounds uncomfortable.
Yeah.
You know, and that whole shit about like sex in a bathroom stall or something, that sounds interesting for 5 minutes, but then I think about that British Airways flight that had to turn around.
Well, the funny thing is the next one is airplane bathroom.
Oh, shit.
Actually, we've all totally done this dozens of times, and it was great every single time. Sexy and plausible. And now I'm going to go back to Mythbusters.
I'm going back to the bathtub statement I said before. Most airplane bathrooms are not built for somebody my size, let alone more than one person in there.
Plus, wouldn't it be obvious that, you know, there's more than one person going into the bathroom?
Typically, yeah, but I'm guessing that this story is meant for people... that don't take up as much room as I do, frankly. You know, even when things are going well, I still have a wide shoulder base that it's hard for me to put shirts around.
You know, the only time I can recall ever being on a plane and I had to use the facilities, I realized I even have to hunch over to, you know, walk in.
Yeah. But you're taller than I am. Okay, well, from there we have our story of the week, and we were going to discuss the Wildstorm series of DV8'N. A couple weeks ago, we talked about Gen 13, and this came up because it is the flip side of the coin of, instead of kids trying to become superheroes, or at least trying to better themselves, what happens when you feed the inner demons of kids? And I remember enjoying this series a lot when I was younger. However, rereading it, it has issues.
I found it very fascinating. I found it very interesting. I think it's something that could be... You can actually do today, to be honest.
No, I'm not saying that it's implausible or that the series concept is bad, but the execution of it way back in 1992, 1993 did leave some things to be desired. The artist that throughout 4 of the 5 issues we read was Humberto Ramos, who's made a lot of great comics recently. However, this definitely was him developing his art style way back when. Mm-hmm. It almost seemed like a lot of the characters were distended and misproportioned.
Yeah, no, I saw that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some of the eyes on them looked like he was going for anime huge eyes, but at the same time, he gave them almost no pupils, so it looked like everybody was constantly on drugs.
Yeah.
Weren't they?
That's a good point.
You know, some of them, but it's just, it made all their stares very vacant. you know, almost like a bunch of Barbie dolls staring at you. You walk in a room and just wonder, what the fuck is wrong with all of you?
We're high.
You say that very convincingly, unfortunately.
Well, they might have been. I agree that the art was kind of, eh.
The art pulled me out of the reach.
The art was mixed for me. It was a bit mixed for me. I saw the misproportioned bodies, but at the same time, it's like, I'm okay with it.
I will say, though, in the reread, the art was the only thing actually pulling me out of the book, because I was kind of enjoying the question of what do superpower beings do when they have almost no ethics?
Right? That was actually really interesting.
It seems like some of them develop a few ethics.
Well, maybe, but that's because you're depending on these other people for your survivability. You know, sooner or later, you got to form some kind of pact with them, otherwise you're a dead person.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it's like no one even attempted to give them ethics. Their runner, Ivana Bayul, the one who ran the Gen 13 project that got all these kids these powers, she wasn't watching them. She was just giving them money and basically saying, now leave me alone until I need you to do something.
Actually, I kind of got the idea she was kind of using them as an experiment to see what they would do without any guidance.
That's what I was getting from it, too.
Actually, that wasn't her purpose. Over the course of the series, the idea of Deviate was, or I guess the official team name was the Deviants, they were her mercenaries. She was using them for actual missions.
But yeah, I got that.
She always passed off the things as being experiments, though. But maybe that was just bullshit that she was telling people to make them think that she had a plan all along.
It wasn't necessarily bullshit. I mean, it wasn't an experiment so much as prototypes. These were the first ones she defrosted.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or at least the most controllable ones. There was a few others, I want to say one or two others that came out during the course of the series. One I'm sure about. But, she kept playing around with the team lineup depending on who was listening, who wasn't, and who was expendable. Not majorly, it's not like a whole bunch of people float in and out of the book. But it was a work in progress. The oddest thing, though, to me about reading the book was one of the easiest things to latch onto was Sideways Bob.
Which one was Sideways Bob?
Sideways Bob was their security man.
Yeah, the guy with a mannequin head.
Oh.
Yes.
I did not realize that was a mannequin head.
Yeah, me either. I actually went back and reread it and said, oh, wait, there's a crack there, so it's not real.
Yeah, I thought it was someone's disembodied head.
Considering the lineup of the story, it very well could have been someone's disembodied head. It wasn't until the second or third issue when he was talking to it about how he found it in a store window that you key into the fact that this wasn't alive. But I gotta admit, the way he introduced himself to everybody, he just said, Dog Boy, say hello to Lucille. I think I'd react about the same way of just meek acceptance.
Yeah, it's like, you got a bunch of these guys who don't give a flying fuck, you're hard as hell, and raise, this guy is presenting a disembodied head.
Yeah, and he's security. You know, boy, I feel better about sleeping at night. I think I'll lock everything I got now.
The one guy you don't want to fuck with.
Oh, Jesus. The lineup was an interestingly eclectic group of powers because they seem to avoid a lot of the stereotypical powers you find in books.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can't remember what Sublime's power was, but...
Density shift.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, she could either go near incorporeal or go as dense as a diamond.
Oh.
She was... If it wasn't for the character of Powerhouse, I'd almost say she was the lone heavy hitter of the crew.
Yeah.
Powerhouse is probably the most odd power setup.
I like it, though.
Yeah.
Converting emotion into muscle is a very hard thing to explain as far as kinetics or biology, but it is one of those powers that presents interesting abilities and weaknesses.
It seems like it's verging on magic, but I'm okay with that.
Well, it seems like he's, you know, he's a powerhouse, you know, Paragon strength, but at the same time, he's partially psychic.
Yeah. To a degree, yeah. Did you read the fifth issue? They had an interesting take on his powers during that one.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, where he was trying to look for a copycat?
Yeah, following the trail of emotions, looking for one person, putting out five different groups of emotions at once. It was an interesting idea. Now, copycat is a conversation.
It's interesting.
Yeah. For those that don't know, copycat is a young lady who I believe is the daughter of a mafioso. Gemma Antonelli is her real name. She has the ability to psionically take over people and make them perform the exact same motion she is.
She's like a puppeteer in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
With minor variations. Obviously, if she's going to make somebody hit herself, she's not going to hit herself as hard as she makes the other person do it.
Yeah.
So there's probably some aspect of exaggeration. But a side effect of her power is that she has multiple personality disorder.
I think there's, what, upwards of three or four?
There's a minimum of five personalities running, it seems like, at most times. There's the soldier, there's Little Jem, which is herself is like a three-year-old,
mm-hmm.
the anarchist.
There's the quiet thinker, or shy thinker.
Yeah, there's the analytical one, and then there's somebody murderous in there, too, like something that's all menace.
The soldier?
Yeah, I don't think I come... No, not the soldier. The soldier, listens to orders. And is the primary defender.
Yeah, but there's something in there that has a bloodlust. You know, it's one of those things where it's a great power combined with a terrific weakness, because you have no idea if the person you're about to ask to do anything will be capable of performing any of it. It's not like different situations force different personalities. It just seems to shift.
Yeah.
The soldier seems to be the more active one out of the group.
Well, that's probably because most of the books we read had to do with combat scenarios.
Yeah.
Frostbite also had a very interesting take on cryokinetic powers.
Actually, it seems like he's more thermal kinetic as opposed to cryo.
That's the thing. I did some reading in later issues. I mean, obviously, I've read the series. It turns out his power isn't necessarily creating ice. The explanation of his powers, according to a few guys, is he's a heat absorber.
Yeah.
He can absorb heat, and then he can send it out in waves. That's how he caused the explosion in issue 2.
Yeah.
Hmm.
You know, that's one of those things that's all kinds of possibilities on how to play with the powers in your writing if you're a smart person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Evo is much easier to explain. He changes into three half-forms, either half-fish, half-bat, or half-wolf.
He was a bit annoying at the beginning.
Yeah.
One note.
Yeah, he was very one note at the beginning. They spent a while fleshing out that character over the course of the series. But again, it's not one note in the form that he was just one archetype, but I mean, you've got a bunch of characters that are supposed to display murderous intent. Somebody's got to be the house idiot.
Yeah, I think he qualifies.
Yeah. And are we missing it? I think that's a central five we just went over.
Frostbite, Copycat, Evo, Powerhouse, and
Sublime.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Then you got Bliss and Threshold. That's another nut
Which is
for another conversation.
What'd you find interesting about it, V?
I don't think I should elaborate.
Oh,
why?
Do. You open the door, might as well walk through.
That whole thing was very kinky.
I think that's putting it lightly.
Yeah, there was a couple cases where the relationship between those two was bouncing dangerously close to incest.
Dangerously close? Did you read the sixth episode?
Yeah.
I didn't read the sixth issue, I read five.
I put the sixth one in there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we were supposed to read 1 through 5. What happened in 6? I forget.
She basically... Oh my god, do you want to tell them?
She went full dominatrix on him with complete with drugs. So he won't remember.
Wow. Now I need to reread this because I completely blanked on that aspect of the relationship.
And the thing is, Jesus. Sublime tried to commit suicide by jumping off a bridge.
Yes.
I remember that. Her powers kicked in reflexively and she couldn't breathe in the water.
She was just
Yeah, she couldn't breathe, but her powers were keeping her alive. So it was she stayed
there. Yeah, she had to eventually slog herself out of the mud just because she figured out she couldn't die that way. Which is an interesting problem to have, frankly. It's one of those things I never thought about. What if your powers prevented you from killing yourself so badly that you just decided, well, living is easier.
But at the very least, we get the idea that all of these characters are broke in some shape, way, or form.
Yeah.
But that's the thing that always drew me to this series, was that when heroes are broken, usually it's like PTSD. You know, they're trying to get over somebody's death so they can become better people. What happens when your problem isn't necessarily PTSD, but just the fact that you've got no one teaching you any sort of morals? and now you've got the power to destroy things almost instantly. What happens to teenagers that have this ability with no leashes? And, you know, in the in my history of reading comics, there's nothing like it. You know, Generation X, Gen 13, freaking New X-Men, New Mutants, everybody's trying so hard to teach them how to do something. Even the villain groups like the Hellions and shit are taught some kind of code about how they're supposed to act, and DV8 is taught nothing.
It seems like they are letting these characters fail and making their own judgments on their own actions.
It was once described as the comic book equivalent of the movie Kids. I know you guys aren't aware of that. No. The movie Kids came out in the mid-90s. It was an independent movie about a group of kids in New York living their day-to-day lives, going to parties. There were no parents or adults seen at all as characters in the movies. And the question a lot of people who saw the movies asked, well, where are the parents? And the director said, that's the point. And that's what this is. This is just a bunch of kids cut loose with powers to their own devices, and this is what happens to them. And that's the part I found the most intriguing. The writer of the series, and I forget who it was smart enough to know that some of them are going to develop ethics just because that's what they know. Some of them are going to develop nothing because of the influences being presented to them. And some are going to fall oddly in between. It's like Bliss during the first 6 episodes, like you said, she started toying with her brother, but at the same time, she was trying to figure out why she couldn't be nice to someone on the team that had just been nice to her. It seemed like she was bouncing between potentially being a likable and unlikable character simply because she couldn't figure out which way the wind blew.
Yep. She's very messed up there.
You know, the easiest to read characters were the ones that were the truly boring ones, like Ivana and Threshold. You knew exactly what the fuck they were.
Yeah.
Even then, we got to see Threshold in vulnerable situations.
Threshold is the character we saw at the beginning of the Gen 13 miniseries, who saw his father killed before him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and he was already messed up. Then there's all kinds of details that come out later in the series. Before I go on, we've gotten the basics of it. We saw these kids perform robberies of government installations, murder, covering themselves, you know, wholesale slaughter for intents and purposes, and try to solve other people's murders.
And top off, we actually got to see him outside of doing all that crap.
Yeah, and that was another thing that really drew me to the series, was that a lot of comic books spend as much time as possible with these characters in some kind of combat situation, in costume, being superheroic. More than half of DV8 seemed to be what these people do in their day-to-day lives.
Yeah.
And it was fucking intriguing. Even with the art style that was turning me out, it was just interesting to read.
Yeah. It's like, we get to see these characters when they're not trying to be, you know, big bass and hard as all hell.
Yeah. You know, is this something that, given a modern remake, I think I would wholeheartedly read this.
Oh, hell yeah. I mean,
as a matter of fact,
this
there
is
was
not
a
dated
modern...
at all.
Yeah. There was a semi-modern remake about 2 or 3 years ago called DV8 Gods and Monsters.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about going to find that because I think I want to see what happens with a more modern take of this group of characters. And frankly, I think there's a lot of missed opportunities for characterization here. The series ended at 32 issues, and the characters were rarely used after that.
I think it's because of...
I think it's the nature of the book, you know. Is even in the 90s, during the Extreme era, this was really stark storytelling. You know, these were not characters who were meant to be heroes.
Right.
But yet they did do...
some heroes.
Good things.
Well, like I said, I think that some of their early teachings with whatever parentage they had did take, but, you know, it's also kind of a base story. This is what happens when absolute power corrupts absolutely. And if you have the possibility to do whatever you want, it's like our pop culture profiling. How many different hero powers do we go through that if you give it to an average person, they're going to go fucking berserk? And that's exactly what they did. The only difference was they had stacks of money and penthouses to go with it.
So, you know, that's actually an element that's kind of removed from them being completely destitute.
Yeah.
Money and a place to live. Okay, what else? Well, they're going to get bored by getting hammered.
Right. It's a great plan for them because as long as they perform, they're being taken care of 100%. So I would really like to see this series remade. DC, non-DC, some kind of different concept take on this. I would like to see a whole villain book of just this. I would love to, I gotta find Gods and Monsters. I gotta find out more about this.
I have to say, this has been more intriguing than most. It's more interesting than a lot of things that we've read. It's more human because they just delve into the more into the monstrous side of, well, humans.
Power, yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's almost like the comic book equivalent of Battle Royal in some places. I will say that my memories from reading all 32 issues, there were several things revealed that kind of threw people sideways. First off, you know, Bliss's powers are supposed to be more or less pheromonal control and some light telepathy. Turns out she'd been playing possum with everybody. She was a full telepath, and she was the reason why Copycat had multiple personality disorder.
What, really?
Oh, she's Xavier.
Yeah, Copycat had figured out that Bliss was driving a lot of the team before they had been taken out of the Gen Project. And to cover her tracks, Bliss used her telepathy to fragment Copycat's persona.
Oh. Wow.
I can also say that during the series, Powerhouse was killed and cloned.
Oh.
And they added another member to the team after Powerhouse died of Freestyle. She was a woman who had a very intriguing power. She could psionically go through a combat situation until she found the best way through it, you know, the optimal way that would cause her the least amount of pain or problem.
She's Midnighter.
Sort of. The thing is, though, as she goes through each individual timeline, she ages respectively in that timeline.
Ah.
So if she doesn't find the solution fast enough, she has artificial aging that pushes her forward potentially into old age.
So she's got to find it quickly.
Right, her cells will regenerate and she'll go back to normal after time, but if she doesn't find the right solution fast enough, all of a sudden you're fighting, like, you know, a 60-year-old woman.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's like Powerhouse. Interesting power that's hard to describe, but has a lot of interesting weaknesses so that you have to know what you're doing. You know, that, and we found out that Callahan, or Threshold and Bliss have a half-sister in the series. Yeah. I'm sorry?
Nothing.
Well, it's an older series, so it's not exactly spoilers, but Gen 13's member Rainmaker is their half-sister.
Really?
Yeah. Hmm. Callahan fathered her. Callahan had sex with an Indian woman, and Rainmaker was the result. So they created this very interesting interconnected universe, and it, you know, also interesting twist, but not exactly a spoiler at this age. Callahan was fucking alive. The guy that got his head turned into a canoe at the beginning of Gen 13, he was alive.
Really?
He had to have been a Gen active then.
He was. Okay. Now, it kind of connects to the whole thing. When Team 7, who was Gen 12, got their powers, some of it worked, some of it didn't. But some of the side effects of that was also regeneration. One of the strongest members to develop powers, Deathblow, was able to be shredded molecularly, but could put himself back together.
Oh, wow.
So,
Wolverine.
No, it's not regeneration. It's more like molecular knitting. So I'm guessing Callahan did something similar to put his head back together.
Hmm.
Still but kind of OP.
Yeah. He lived. He ended up taking Frostbite, Sublime, and Copycat. Evo decided to follow Bliss like a lovesick dog. Threshold wanted nothing to do with any of them.
That makes sense.
You know, I don't remember necessarily what happened to Powerhouse and Freestyle, but I don't remember either of them sticking around the what was left of the team. You know, Sublime, Frostbite, and Copycat just came to really trust each other, especially when Copycat could remember who the fuck she was.
Yeah, those,
so that's a long... Sorry?
I was going to say, those are the characters kind of gravitated towards...
Oddly enough, yeah, even though they were all homicidal, you could see little bits of humanity? Redeemable individuals in those three.
Yeah.
And I say very little bits.
The only one that you don't see anything in is Ivana. Is that wrong?
Oh, yeah.
She's a cold-hearted bitch.
Yeah.
If she wasn't such a 90s stereotype, she would be frightening. But unfortunately, you know, just the cold, detached, might-murder-you thing is a little played out in current context.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's hard for me to say. It's hard for me to recommend find this series and read it. But at the same time, there's enough different stuff in it. Going back to the original series is worth a read. Now, remake, totally behind that.
Mm-hmm.
I think this could be done today, and with modern writing being what it is and the risk comic books are taking, this could be an incredible series. So, I don't know. Would you two actually seek out the rest of the series to read it?
Yeah.
Maybe.
I'm rather curious. I mean, as far as the whole dark, you know, gory bit, I've seen worse. Really.
I thought the biggest risk they took in this series was a character called Virginia Dentata. That
was a bit.
When I was a kid and read this at like 13, 14, didn't understand the joke. When I went and reread it like 3 years later and, you know, my hormones were finally evening out, I read that and just went, oh. Damn.
But I find it interesting that when we started going down the lab of image stuff, we went from, like, bad to good to, oh, hell yeah.
Yeah.
It's like a gradual increase.
Yeah, you know, that's the thing with most things from your childhood. There's things that you're going to remember as great that you find out actually hold up, like Gen 13 and DV8. There's things you thought of as great that just won't hold water, like Wetworks in the original Transformers series.
G.I. Joe and everything else from the 80s.
You know, there's parts of me that wants to go back and watch, like, the first couple seasons of Thundercats, and then I think, why do I want to torture myself?
But when I saw Brand New, I thought it was horrible.
So, I don't know. I'm one of the few people I know that like the Thundercats remake, but that's me.
It started off strong, but it nosedived fast for me.
Yeah. That's a whole other conversation. Okay, our interview for next week unfortunately fell through, so we need a topic for next week.
Daredevil?
The TV show? Yeah. Fuck it, sold.
Okay. Need to watch it now.
It's not exactly a hard conversation, and she's right. It's topical. It's right there.
Yeah. And I've already watched part of it, so.
Gives you an excuse to actually finish watching it.
Yeah, great. I gotta get a Netflix account now.
I could...
I don't think you would say that over the internet.
No.
All right. So next week, how many episodes? Three?
I don't care. As many you guys want.
13! No.
Well, there's only going to be six, damn it.
No, there is going to be... all 13 episodes are out.
Oh.
All 13 episodes came out on Friday.
I would be willing to watch the full
13. I'm behind, episodes. So...
Let's watch as many as we feel like getting to.
That's like four or five, then? Wait, how long are the episodes?
An hour.
Oh, three.
Three is fine. Three is good.
Span. Okay, well, yeah, I'm sure some of us will watch more than that. We just may have to watch our language, because if we mention the word spoilers, V will reach through and throttle all of us just for the sake of it. All right, so next week we'll talk the new Daredevil series. Thank you very much for tuning in. I invite you to roll with us again next week. Have a great weekend. I am Jeremy.
Jesse.
And V.
Don't jerk and drive. Have a great one, people.
I hate you.
Or don't.